tell you, by 10:30, I said, can we go in? Let's turn it off.
They behaving?
No.
Good. I don't want to behave.
Hey, good evening. Welcome to the Board of Selectmen's meeting for Tuesday, March 1st, 2016. We're holding the meeting of the Allegiance.
The Allegiance to the flag of the United States of America, and to the Republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
This is the opening official board of selectmen's meeting. I'm in home session early, so nothing to report there. We'll start off the meeting as we always do with the public forum. Residents are invited to share ideas, opinions, or ask questions regarding the town government. Do we have anyone for the public forum this evening? Seriously?
Actually,
what's this? The public forum?
Yeah. Hi, young man. Name and address.
Yeah, John Catino, 1 David Joseph Road. Yeah, this is actually a more powerful mic than the one up there in reality. A little over a year ago, the visioning committee convened and came up with a vision statement for Hopkinton. A vibrant, welcoming community, it begins with. And I believe over the past few months, many in Hopkinton have made it anything but. I came from a long line of volunteers. This volunteerism award in my father's name, given out in the city of Cambridge every year. Many of you know that one of my favorite sayings is, no thanks necessary. It's what we do. We take care of each other. I and many of my colleagues stepped up and were elected to this board and others to help out our friends, neighbors, and businesses. The last three elections for selectmen were all unopposed, and this year only three people have stepped up for the two seats. Could it be because many of them are just afraid, or I don't know. Over the past few months, some of us have been personally insulted, publicly bullied, and our kids harassed, and our houses even egged. Is this our Hopkinton? Might that be why no people are stepping up? You know, I'll stand up to bullies. However, in this position, should I have to also protect my children and my home? Is that our Hopkinton? Several meetings ago, the board was accused of not attending all town events. However, throughout my tenure, I've been to many, many events, and notably every retirement over the past few months. And I've had to endure continued ridicule from MCs, DJs, presenters, and even one case, the host. It wasn't very much fun from the events that I attended, expecting just to go there and honor the retiree. Again, is that our Hopkinton? There are lots of decisions that have to be made by various boards and committees in the town, and I don't believe that any one of the members was born with the wisdom of Solomon. So many may walk away unhappy. So if that's true, please keep in mind that we all volunteer for these positions to serve our friends and neighbors and to take care of one another. Could we please live up to our visioning statement and again stay friends and neighbors? Thanks.
Okay, anybody else for the public forum? All right. Seeing no takers, we'll move on to the consent agenda. I'm just going to take the liberty of breaking it out tonight. So first is the minutes. The board will consider accepting the following public session minutes of February 23rd, 2016. Chair will entertain a motion.
So moved.
Second.
Motion second. Discussion. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, present, not voting. That's unanimous. Second is I'm going to skip down to item number 3, a one-day liquor license, an action item. The board will consider approving a one-day liquor license, wine and malt beverage only, request from Elizabeth Burke on behalf of St. John the Evangelist Youth Group. On April 9th, 2016, from 6 to 10 p.m. at the St. John's Parish Center, this is a youth group fundraiser, and proceeds will go toward youth group activities. Does anyone have any questions about this fundraiser?
So it's a youth group fundraiser that adults will attend and use the liquor license, correct?
Yes.
Just want to make sure. There's a lot of youth group in this memo here. I'm all set.
Yes. All right. So, good. Any other questions about the liquor license? The permitting request is so we get the standard comments, tip certification, all that. Okay. Chair, I'll entertain a motion to approve the one-day liquor license.
So moved.
Second.
Okay, we got a second. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, present, not voting. That is unanimous as well. And now we're going to take up the night's big, enjoyable event here. The Board of Selectmen will now recognize Bill Lukey for his 33 years of service in the Hopkinton Fire Department. Chief, you want to come on up and light this off?
Sure. Well, thanks a lot. I think Maria is going to do a little teamwork with me on the introduction, right? You want to do a little, or okay? So our team plan. So I think the big thing I want to start off with is Bill has given a lot of dedication and time to this community, to the department. He started as from Woodville, I like to say, as his hometown area, and spent a lot of time building fire trucks. He was recognized as a talented mechanical guy, picked up by our community, and I want to welcome him in and give thanks to him for the third time in a few weeks here as we've been trying to celebrate his departure.
Celebration fatigue.
Thank you very much. Maria has a few words I think she wants to pass along, or no? You want me to do it?
Yeah, so I mean, Maria was kind enough to give me some things to say. So, so Bill, let's see. So his history: 33 years on the fire department in total.
Yes. Yep.
Began out working on fire trucks. Actually, became a call firefighter in 1983. Transitioned to a career firefighter in 1989.
Correct.
And apparently, it's in the family blood, right? Your
yes. Well, it all started back when my grandfather had the business in town here. Okay. At one time, there was three manufacturers of fire apparatus, and his was one of them. And so
in
I
Woodville?
Got what's that?
In Woodville.
In Woodville, on Winter Street, right where Eddie Murphy has a place now. Of course, now it's Bulldog Fire Apparatus, but. Okay. Yeah, I started as a youngster and going to my grandfather's shop and saying, oh boy, this is going to be great. And I thought it was going to be my life, but it didn't turn out that way because, but I did get to meet some interesting people, some fire chiefs, some which kind of, you know, I saw how they did things and what they did, and I'm like, wow, this is interesting. So Arthur Stewart, when he was chief in town, he came to the shop one day and said, oh, he says, my spies tell me that you want to get on the fire department. I said, yeah. And then I didn't hear nothing. I'm like, all right, well, wait a minute. So it took a little bit, and then one day he says, come on up to the drill tonight. We're going to have a drill. So I'm like, all right, here I am. I don't know what's going on, you know. So I went up there with the engine 2 crew, and we practiced and did some stuff. And then he says, yeah, you're officially on the fire department. Oh, okay. So that's my beginnings. And then I enjoyed helping people, and my two brothers were on the department as well. And it's a great career. It certainly is. Knowing that you can go out and help somebody, even if it's just to say hi. I mean, in the last few years, we've been able to get out in the community. People have come up and said hi, and it's really cool. So it's an interesting career. I just hope that my colleagues stay safe for their entire careers. I was, you know, like I could consider myself lucky to, not that we had any big fires, but whether it's a fire in Boston, Woodville, or Hopkinton, it's all the same. It doesn't matter. I mean, they just have more guys that they can throw at it at the same time. But that's it. That's all in a nutshell. And I appreciate you guys. I appreciate working for the town. To the citizens, thank you very much for a lifetime career. Thank you.
That's wonderful. I think we have a little on behalf of a grateful town. You can, oh, yes. We have. Go ahead, Norman.
Yes, on behalf of town hall staff, we want to thank you for 33 years of service. And we have a wonderful gift card at the Blissful Meadows Golf Club.
All right, enjoy. In 6 weeks, I'll be free, and I can go with you.
Thank you very much, Bill. Yeah.
Thank you, everybody.
All right. Congratulations, Bill. Enjoy yourself.
Thank you.
Thank you again. Next item on the agenda, the Board of Selectmen will formally discuss appointing representatives to the MAPC SWAP subregion, along with the Planning Board member, which will need to appoint a representative. The Board of Selectmen can appoint up to two, one of whom must be the MAPC representative, and the MAPC and the Planning Board, rather, must appoint one. Holy cow, this is complicated. Mr. Kamal, anything I missed on this?
No.
Okay. So, go ahead.
Through the chair. Elaine has been the town's representative, and I think she's done a terrific job. If the board is so inclined, and the Planning Board supports that, recommending that she continues to represent the town.
So is she our representative, or is she the Planning Board's appointee?
Do we get one or two?
It says up to two.
It's up to two.
Up to two, and we've appointed one.
Yeah, I'm sorry? Yeah, exactly. So we can just grab her before the Planning Board meets and just do it that way?
Yes.
First come, first serve kind of thing?
First come, first serve.
Okay. Elaine, are you currently our appointee? Did we do this? You don't think you've ever been appointed? No, we get firefighters who just show up, and we got planning. We got MAPC people who just take jobs. If I knew it was this easy, I wouldn't have run. So Elaine's been there, and the question is, do we want to continue? Any thoughts on the board, John? You got any thoughts about this?
I do not.
Do not. Zero thoughts. Other John. Any. Okay. And Megan, Todd, you want to volunteer?
No, I don't.
No. Okay. Good. Brian,
I'm still confused.
So the minimum we can appoint up to two people, and the Planning Board has to appoint one person, right? We've only, as a town, though, we've only ever had one appointee previously. It sounds like, who wasn't even really appointed. Which is Elaine, huh?
Was not appointed.
Right. So we've actually had zero appointees historically, and now, but Elaine has gone in our behalf.
So now we're going to appoint possibly one, maybe two.
And then the Planning Board has to appoint one.
They could appoint the same person we appoint, correct?
Can you overlap appointments? Can they do the same thing?
If we appoint Elaine, can they appoint Elaine and then we're all good?
Well, that's their problem. I don't know.
Good point. Okay. Now I'm not confused.
Would anybody like to nominate anybody else besides Elaine? Okay. Would anybody, or appoint Elaine? All right. Chairman, I entertain a motion to appoint Elaine Lazarus as the Board of Selectmen's representative to the MAPC
Second.
Swap. Okay. Vigorous motions and seconds. Any further discussion? All in favor say aye.
Aye.
Aye. Opposed, President voting. That's unanimous. Elaine, congratulations. You're officially on the committee. All right, another crisis resolved. Tonight's big show, item number 4, the Town Manager Fiscal Year 2017 Budget Recommendation. It's an action item. Per the Town Charter, Section 6-2E, the Town Manager will appoint an will submit an FY17 comprehensive budget to the Board of Selectmen.
Mr. Chairman?
Yes, sir.
Did we cover the Marathon Fund report?
Oh, I'm sorry. I didn't mention that. We asked them to come in and discuss that live, and the person couldn't make it tonight.
Okay.
So we're taking that off until the next meeting.
Thank you.
Apologies. I forgot to mention that. School Committee, Appropriation Committee, and the Capital Improvement Committee are invited to the discussion. Mr. Kamalo, over to you. And actually, really over to Chris. But.
Yes. thank you, Mr. Chair. Chris and I will share with the board very brief remarks on the proposed FY17 Comprehensive Budget and Financing Plan. We did distribute the plan in the form of an email as well as copies tonight. Overall, I'll just give you the highlights of the proposed FY17 budget. It totals $80,443,827.
It's incredible.
Which is an increase of approximately $1.5 million or 1.98% from the FY16 approved budget. This number represents an overall tax impact of 2.63% net of new growth. 2.63%.
Thank you.
Yes, overall, this is a level service budget marked by a thoughtful effort on the part of the town committees, boards, and staff in continually exploring new ways of meeting increasing service demands and needs. In terms of highlights, overall, big picture, general debt service increases 3.6%, which is approximately $164,000 over FY16. Fixed costs are increasing 8.35%. School operating costs are increasing 4.49%. Municipal operating costs are increasing 7.02%. The sewer enterprise increases 0.93%. The water enterprise decreases by 7.7%. Park and rec enterprise also is decreasing 3.7%. Let me also share with you that these percentages are given strictly as a guideline and as a planning tool. There are three reasons why this is important to emphasize. Number one, in compiling this statistic, we did not account for offsets. Offsets could be in the form of revolving funds. They could also be in the form of grants. They could also be in the form of continuing appropriations. Secondly, I know and I'm very proud of the slogan that we have had in town, that this is a one town. We don't have what you find in other communities where the school is on one side, the town is on one side. We are one town, one solution. And thus, in terms of expenses, it needs to be said that what you see, for example, is the town's increase of 7.02%. That number includes fringe benefits and other costs that apply to school employees. And then thirdly, it also needs to be said that we are looking at this issue from a long-term perspective. We want to continue working with the whole team to identify some precise way of better articulating this information. So the point I'm making is these percentages that you see are presented as a guideline, they're presented as a planning tool. Please don't read them as the most precise data that we can present on this budget.
And then specifically, on the municipal side, here the key operating budget changes from 16 to 17. The police budget is increasing 76,000, and that's covering personnel costs. Fire increases as well. We have approximately 105,000 increase, and that too is covering personnel costs as well as overtime. DPW, and this is, I think, important to emphasize, this is the year where the town has to pay, we believe strongly, the stormwater phase two implementation costs. That budget is going up by 220,000. Also, pavement management increases amounting to 351,000. In the past years, we have had a carry forward budget amount. Unfortunately, this year we don't have that, and therefore we have to appropriate that from our general fund appropriation. Health insurance, negotiations are still in place. We are budgeting approximately 621,000. As we've done in other years, we're continuing to work diligently to make sure that this increase is kept to a minimum and that we protect the interests of the taxpayers as well as the employees. Blanket insurance is going up by 51,000. Middlesex County retirement increases in the amount of 107,000. Fixed cost changes in the budget reflect the following. Health insurance, already explained, negotiations are still in place, in progress. Middlesex has provided us with a formal notice that the increase this year is going to be 6.23%. Chris will provide more details as to how this will impact the community in FY17 and the outlying years. OPEB Trust, the proposed FY17 funding of 612,647 is based on the funding plan approved by the board in 2015. Under that plan, the unfunded liability will be fully funded by 2045. The current balance in the trust fund is 826,646. Capital Improvement Program. The proposed budget totals 3,711,394. Of which approximately 2.9 million will be bonded. And as we have done in the past years, 809,394 will be pay as you go. As a matter of policy, we have taken the position that balancing debt with pay as you go protects the town from unforeseen capital costs and has been well received by the town's credit rating agencies. On the revenue side, we are projecting approximately $22 million in revenues, which is a decrease of approximately $1.3 million or 5.93% from FY2016. Chris will provide details in terms of the assumptions behind these numbers. As in past years, the proposed budget is also adding $300,000 to the Town Stabilization Fund. And here's why. It's now important to highlight that the changes that we're anticipating in the economy, the increased need to preserve the town's debt capacity, and the likely normalization of the new growth numbers actually compels us to really put a strong effort in bringing our stabilization fund to approximately 5% of the operating budget. That's the threshold that is specified in the town's financial policies. And the key reason as to why we're just suggesting 300,000 is the fact that we're actually of the opinion that in 2 years' time, it's going to be important for the town to really address its financial health in light of the likely decline in the new growth numbers. And with that in mind, we're thinking that in the next 2 years, the town should put approximately 300,000 each year in this fund, and that will bring us to approximately right around 3.5, 3.8 million, which is a number that is set as the target in our financial policies. Further, and this is very, I think, important in terms of my message to the board tonight,
I'm recommending the following proposed initiatives, which at this point are not included in the budget as presented. Growth-driven and pressing staffing needs. We've identified through our discussions with department heads the following needs. Youth and Family Services Counselor, part-time. Information Technology Help Desk Technician, part-time. Senior Center Receptionist, part-time. Public Works Heavy Equipment Operator, part-time. Facilities Custodian, particularly in view of the fact that in the coming 2 years, we're rolling in to our building our program, two expanded buildings, the DPW and the library. We only have two people in that department. Also, the children's library technician, part-time. Town clerk administrative assistant, part-time. Human resources assistant, part-time. And then the assistant town manager, which is a topic that the board has been discussing with the community in the last 2 years. I respectfully urge the board to review this list for funding in FY17. Secondly, in discussions with our team members on the school team, I'm highlighting the need for the town to address the bus parking lot and the design of the AstroTurf field as strategic initiatives. And my recommendation is that the two projects be funded through excess levy. Both projects, I believe, have prospective community-wide benefits, and therefore I'm urging that the town comes together around these projects and decides the way forward starting in FY17.
Sorry, Mr. Kamala, could you repeat that? Which two projects?
The bus parking lot and the AstroTurf field proposed.
AstroTurf field?
High school.
High school.
High school?
Yes. At this point, I think I'm leaving this as a discussion point. There are numbers that we have received in terms of what the bus parking lot may cost. I've also been in discussions with Kathy in terms of what the design might cost for the AstroTurf field, but that's a number that I think needs to be refined further. But the message simply is, let's identify these as strategic initiatives that have a community-wide benefit.
Got it.
Okay. As the budget review process unfolds, we are urging the board as well as staff to continue to monitor and report on the following issues. The Park and Recreation Commission income, expenses, and subsidy. Excess levy, snow and ice expenses. Hopefully, John, I didn't jinx you by mentioning the phrase snow and ice. Overlay account, debt service ratio, FY17 local aid receipts and estimated local aid assessments, the impact of the EMC Dell merger on the local economy, and the new growth revenues that are imminently winding down to normal levels. As I always say, I want to take this opportunity to thank Chris Sandini, the new CFO, Dr. Kathy McLeod, the school superintendent, the department heads, as well as the town boards and committees for helping us through this process. And as we have said in past years, this is a long journey. It's just the beginning of a long discussion that will culminate at town meeting. And I believe, given the list that I've shared with the board, we have some work to do. Mm. And at this point, with the chair's permission, I would like Chris to provide more details in terms of the revenue estimates.
Yeah, and before Chris starts, let's just talk about what the plan is to go forward here. So for everyone's benefit, so we have this on the agenda for the next three meetings. Next 3 weeks in a row is the plan. The plan is to talk about the budget as needed. And there's three elements to that, right? There's the operating budget, which I think we'll start off with tonight. Then there's the capital articles, you know, pay-as-you-go things that are in the back here. And then eventually we'll look to take up the warrant articles at a later time. So so I'd like to go through them in that order. Start with the operating budget. If we can get through that tonight, great. If not, we'll continue next week, and then we'll go to the capital projects afterwards, and I think spend some time on those, because I think there's a fair amount of questions. We're not knowledgeable about any of these capital projects at this point, so we're going to have to really spend some time, I think, talking through all those. And then we'll just see how it goes. So if we need all three meetings, which I suspect we will, great. If we don't, we'll visit that later. And then we have the school committee and the appropriations committee and capital improvements here tonight to ask questions as well. So what I'd like to do is we'll have Chris start, we'll go to the board for initial questions, and then we'll kind of walk around all the other committees and let them have questions, and then we'll just sort of get into it. Okay? So Chris, let's go.
Sorry, Mr. Chair.
Yes, sir.
Just kind of on a parallel with Chris making comments about the town side of the budget, I was wondering if we could get input at the same time from the schools on their side of the budget.
Sure. Why don't we have Chris go through the whole thing overall, and then can we go through Chris's stuff first, and then we'll go to the schools and let them do it all at once? Because present and we can do it.
Yeah. Let's go that way.
Okay. Chris, off to you.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Hello, everybody. First of all, I'll start off by saying thank you. First to Norman, he's been a tremendous help. Not being from this community, I've had to learn what the philosophy has been, what a whole host of circumstances has been, and he's been kind enough to be patient enough to take multiple questions from me every day. I would note that this is like a huge weight lifted off of both our shoulders today. This is a monumental task that we've both been working on very hard. I did notice that Norman is absolutely walking with more of a little pop in his step today, which I was glad to see that. I think he's kind of relaxed a little bit that we have a really well thought out product. And so I'd also like to thank the Appropriations Committee for your indulgence and for your giving me the space in order to produce this project. I do know that you must be chomping at the bit to get moving on this, and now that this part is behind us, that certainly will happen fairly soon. And the same sentiments I also express to the board for their indulgence also. I expect to meet with you folks more regularly to give you updates on what's going on. With that said, I would first like to tell you I have a little methodology that I go through and which I went through in order to prepare this. And then I'll go through the general structure and we'll point out some things that you should, you'll probably have some questions on. So with that, I have basically six steps that I go through when I'm developing a budget. First, I identify the types of financial resources available to support that budget. I mean, you don't start with the expense side. You have to know what you can afford before you ever have a discussion about expenses. I then estimate the levels of those resources in a reasonably conservative manner so as to lessen the possibility of unanticipated crisis that can result from estimates of revenues, if you will. With a broad brush, I evaluate recent history of the expenditures of the various departments and establish targets for spending that fall within the estimated availability of funding. And along with that, we have the selectmen's direction at the beginning of December. I analyze any new service proposals in light of their desirability, cost, and sustainability. Consider contingency plans for increases or decreases in funding beyond projections. Utilize financial surpluses to restore and maintain sufficient reserve capacities. So those are the main things that I try and keep in mind while I'm going through and while we are discussing with the department heads what the town is able to afford. This document is nothing but looking in the future. Norman will tell you that every one of these numbers, there's one thing you can be sure, none of them will be spot on. We can only hope that we make reasonable estimates. And if you consider, if you take that out into the future and you look at 2020, beyond a reasonable estimate based on a percentage, there is no way in order to predict those any further than that. One of them that is really going to be all over the place is your debt service levels. As far as what you're going to pay on your debt service in the year 2019 on projects that may not have been proposed yet, is folly to ever think that that's going to be any sense reality. So that the most we can do is to take an educated guess. With that, I will go through the financial model summary, which is the first handout that you have that's two pages that says operating budget summary. Now, in keeping with exactly what accountants ought to do, we start out with expenses and then we go to revenues. So the first part of the financial model, if you will, in the budget summary is your basically your department's budgets. There you'll find where the departments came and requested funds for the continuing year. Also in there, you will see your community preservation budget, your sewer water enterprise budgets, and your parks and rec budgets. That is your top figures. In the middle, other amounts to be raised are other items that don't fall neatly into that, such as monies that go to stabilization, monies that are for snow and ice, if you will, those types of expenses. And I'll go through more of that in a minute. And then on the next page, on page two, you'll see the estimated receipts and availability of funds. This is what we've come up with as our best guess for how we're going to finish 16, because 16 is a good indicator on how 17 is going to go. So again, just the same with the expenses, the farther you get out into the future, the more off you're going to be in your estimates, and you will notice that some of them are very conservative, and that's by design. Again, you don't want to get caught short. And as we go on and as we're more confident that revenues are increasing, we can adjust those, or maybe we find that that there are sources that are actually decreasing and we can make the adjustments at that time. Going back to the first page, you see that in any budget, you'll see it set up and it goes from general government all the way down to employee benefits. I'll only highlight, since Norman already did to quite an extent, I'll be brief. General government went up about 6.6%, I think. Most of that is just various departments that we identified shortfalls this year, and therefore we have to budget them for next year. So although the increase looks to be a little bit significant, some of that can be explained by the fact that there were certain items that were not either budgeted correctly or budgeted in the wrong department, or things came to light during the year. Public safety is a nominal increase. Hudson Public Schools, again, they can speak to their own budget. Their budget went up 4.5%, which is in line with what their recent increases have been over the last 4 or 5 years. I will talk about Keefe Tech in a minute, but you will notice that that's level funded. Public Works went up quite a bit, and much of that can be explained by various mandates that Mr. Westerling has been given. And when Mr. Westerling speaks to his budget, he can explain those further. Debt service has actually gone up a very nominal amount. Next year, it is, as you can see, in 18, it's slated to go up quite a bit more. That's just the way the funding schedules are shaking out. employees' benefits and insurance is going up quite a bit, and again, that's due to Norman spoke to this a little bit, and some of that is due to health insurance, the uncertainty in health insurance.
Chris,
yes.
As much as I enjoy seeing places I want to go, can we put the numbers up on the screen here so people can see them? Oh, if only I had an IT director. So. You can keep going, Chris. I just want people to be able to see what you're talking about.
Health insurance, there's a significant budgeted increase. We've had some indications that number may rise a bit due to certain circumstances, but at the same time, we're hopeful that will not be the case. And then you have your community preservation and your enterprise funds. Those have been budgeted based upon the study that is done every year, and also by the department's actual needs as they've put forth to us and been vetted by us. Down below, I'll just point out, you have your pay-as-you-go at $759,000. Snow and ice, John, I didn't actually speak to John about this figure, but I noticed that right now we're about $20,000 in the red. So although I imagine that's going to rise, I have a figure in there currently at $200,000 as far as what will be short this year, which will be funded next year, as the way we're currently setting the plan. I understand that can change, and I understand in Hopkinton we've funded it through the normal budgeting process, and we can have that discussion as well. And then you have your other things, your state and county charges. That's just what the state has told us that we have to pay. It's for things, I'm drawing a blank at the moment. I'll go on and get back to that. And then you have your community preservation funds that will be utilized during the year. And that's all set based upon what we've calculated as far as what we will receive in taxes, as well as the state what the state is proposing to give us as a match for that. And then you have your transfer to stabilization, which Norman said is at $300,000 with a goal of eventually getting that up to $3.5 million. And the OPEB trust as well, which is slated to be fully funded in 2045. One quick thing about the OPEB trust, this is great stuff. I love seeing this. It gets me very excited that, because this is the elephant that's been in the room the last 5 years. Every time we have the talk with rating agencies, we know it's going to circle to that, and so for a community to actually be responsible enough to do something is a good feeling. Then we come to receipts. As you can see, receipts are basically, in any community, they're basically three different components. There's your local aid, and then there's your state aid, and then by far the largest component is your taxes. So as you can see, we have local revenue, which is basically your fees. It's your local revenue is basically your fees. It's anything from fees to
can we put that tab up now?
It's basically motor vehicle is the motor vehicle is the largest component by far. Pilot payments, which is just a payment in lieu of taxes, fees and penalties, and interest. Then we come down to state aid. State aid is based upon what the governor proposed budget is. It'll almost certainly rise somewhat once it gets to House Ways and Means and the Senate subcommittee, and ultimately to the full legislature for a vote. But right now, that is budgeted as the initial numbers that those folks have come out with. We have a rather large receipt from Mass State Buildings Committee, and that's for construction projects that we've partnered with the state to build, for school construction projects we've partnered with the state to build. We have our appropriation of free cash, which is at 2.3, which is slated to pay pay-as-you-go items. Then you have your sewer revenues, which are within the guidelines set by the study that's performed every year, and also every one of the three funds, the parks and rec, the water, and the sewer, are all self-funded at this point. That doesn't mean we shouldn't have a discussion on those, and I know that you folks are very interested in that. So that's the overall picture of where we're at, and as Norman said, we're ending up with a little over 2.5% on net of new growth, and about $1.6 million, and I'll get into that more in a minute. A couple of points I'd like to make as I was going through this. Although revenue seemingly decreases dramatically, 6%, it's going from 23,500,001. If you remove EPA, the enterprise funds, self-balancing, the free cash yield, which we consider a revenue source, actually retained earnings as a revenue increase or decrease, we're pretty much flatlined on our receipts. General fund receipts were budgeted at the same level in FY16. State aid based on governor's budget was okay. Regional vocational school, we estimated at level funded. I called the business manager over there, and although she didn't have anything definite for me, they were going up approximately 3.5%. We have a reduction from 19 to 16. So when I did when I ran those numbers, I actually came out with a lower number than the number I have here. Being conservative, I budgeted the full amount, and we'll adjust that when they come out with their budget. Middlesex Retirement adopted an aggressive fund. I had a conversation with those folks, and I also read their report. They're targeting the system to be fully funded by 2035. It calls for an aggressive increases of about 6% until 2020, and then going down into the range. For this, as I was digging into their notes, is that many of their assumptions are false, and not just for Middlesex, but for all of the public retirement systems in Massachusetts. Their rate of return assumptions, their increase assumptions, have all been shown to be overly aggressive, and new laws on the books requiring pension systems to get audits. Believe it or not, until now they have not had So now that they're having an to reality. Levy is currently set at almost 1.6 million. That figure will change, though, as more estimates become firm numbers. The excess levy is sort of a town's overall financial and something of a report card of our own performance. Conversations with rating analysts have shown that I'm not alone in that thinking. They regard it as the town's ability to obligations demonstrate potential problems down the road. New growth rated at about 1.4 million, and all signs so far that I've seen in conversations I've had indicate that that's a slight conservative side. In 16, it was 1.542.
Chris, what's the stabilization balance right now?
2.5, and then Norman can give you the
2.4. Yeah.
2.4 million.
And then appropriations from free cash. That's the only line I didn't understand. You tie that. What does that tie to? See on page 2, appropriations from free cash, the town manager, 2.998.
Yes.
Where does that in this?
It doesn't. The way the financial model is set up, there are certain components that are on the side of the four.
Okay. Yes.
If you're interested in the breakdown as to how we have apportioned it, we have that detail.
I'd like to see it at least just what the number looks like, because it sort of jumps out at me as something completely different. Okay. Do you have anything to say about before we dive into questions here? No, you're good. Okay, school committee has nothing to say with the school budget. Okay. So let's go to the board for questions. Mrs. Sestar, you want to just dive right in?
I'd prefer if it came around to me again.
Okay, Mr. Herr.
Couple of things. First, on stabilization, about
years ago, our budget was roughly $1 million. At that time, our stabilization was about 1.2 million, and Standard & Poor's up bond rating. So I'm struggling with putting another $300,000 in when we're close to $200,000. North from there as we look at the tax impact of 2.63%. So I think the community is stable. I think stable and dialogue about this, but that's one of my first sort of impressions and something that jumped out at me.
We'll talk about it. You want to get
Let me just throw a table here and see what sticks. Secondly, specific to the school budget, I attended one of the school budget presentations. I think I attended two. Principals and others presented their budget numbers to the school committee. I was very impressed with the thorough nature of those, and probably more than anything else, how the principals and others that presented broke their budgets down to need and then built back up from there and then presented that they were looking for. And I think in two cases, they needed less than they'd had in FY. And that was very impressive to me, the kind of budgeting that I think we'll be doing, and comfortable with the school budget number this year, the process had in the past. And then finally, I don't understand that free cash, Mr. Placo, that you raised. I think we're going to further, right? And that's it. Other than that, Chris, I think you've done a fabulous job here. You haven't been here very long. You obviously know your stuff, and I'm very comfortable with on the path to put forward a good budget for the community away at town meeting. My only request is we realization.
All right. So let's start off with that. talk to the rationale behind that?
And address Mr. Hare's question directly. Back then, Brian, you will recall that Standard & Poor's upped the town's rating to AA. Back then, the stabilization fund, and we had convinced them, alongside the soft reserve. I can tell you that going forward, these discussions with Standard & Poor's that reference the soft reserve will not be entertained positively for two reasons. One, they're moving away from concepts that some number, that some money that they have to strengthen its liquidity, want real reserves. Two, in our case, respectfully, because the town had the underwrite vote, any discussion of the soft reserve will entail bringing up the underwrite vote, and that will not be received positively.
They have guidelines, right? Yes. That they go to.
They have a wish list.
Sure. Well,
it's a wish list. And we were underneath the wish list. Bond rating, with all due respect. So it's up there, and we were under it at that time. So now, well above that number. This number is, or there's something else going on because the cash is a lot deeper, yet they're still saying we need to put some more in. So
I think that
something to dig further on. That's all.
And then
I
just like debating with Mr. Kamala.
Partially to the recollection 6 years ago, having a $70 million a little bit off. I think that we were at that point anyway, so we're looking at about a 33% increase on that.
Yeah, 2015 it was 70.
Did you say my recollection was off?
Yes, I did, sir.
Okay.
So it may.
Yeah. We take the mics off now.
Okay, it's going to start. So the second comment was school, and so it begins. The second comment was schools, rah-rah, and then the third comment was the free cash thing. Right, and I do think we need to get that, we'll get that sheet, but it's essentially an accounting convention. It's sort of these things coming in a net basis. Go ahead.
In fact, for the its benefit, the actual numbers. The certified free cash stands at $2,382.62. The way it's apportioned this FY17 budget, we have approximately $800,000 going to capital, transferred to general station $300,000, transferred to OPEF trust $612,000 approximately. And ICE, $200,000. Pavement management, $351,000. That's phase two, is approximately $136,000. So we do have this breakdown.
That adds up. Okay.
So we're going to talk about this next couple of weeks, right?
We'll get
further.
With questions and thoughts, we'll be fine. We'll come back and revisit next week, and then we'll do it the week following as needed. Mr. Mosier.
Things, I know we'll probably have a longer discussion, a specialized discussion around this that we usually do on a specialized fund. It looks to be relatively level funded this year. That always seems to always look a little more dire. I'm assuming we're going to take a specific look at that within this budget.
Well, that comes to the rate setting exercise we do later on in the spring, right?
Also, thanks to the community, we are also in the middle of doing a detailed study for our business enterprise.
And then the other thing that kind of reminded me for the school, I would like to finally, once and for all, understand the finances around the AstroTurf field replacement for Fruit Street. I think we talked in some way, shape, or form, and the numbers are always unclear. I really want to understand what the finances that look like, what the town is, what the financial liability for replacing that is, what the HYSA's role is, and what the numbers. years look like.
So next week, can we put a deep dive on Parks and Rec in the budget, in the agenda? Okay. All that stuff. We want to do their enterprise fund, the whole thing.
Yes. In fact, I should share with the public, we had good conversations and representatives of the commission receive from the director a detailed program.
Okay.
It is. And then on Friday, we will report in the packet to the board.
Okay. To be here next week to really go deep on the rock budget.
Okay. Yeah, and then the stormwater system, like you mentioned, there was some plant with the state this year. But those are projected out for 2018, 19, and 20, the same amount. So is this a very large ongoing project, not just something we're going to cover this year?
Yes, this is a project, and with the board's permission, John will be providing details. There's a plan that has been worked out. How many town consortium, John?
30.
30 town consortium. So we do have a detailed plan with detailed accounting for that we presented to the board.
Well, some.
When do you want to go through that? Go through this. All right, let's round to questions, and then we'll do the debt. So
just real quick on this. So will some hopefully overlap with the downtown corridor project?
Separate?
No.
None of it?
It's a totally separate thing. It's every storm drain in town, basically.
Hoping that would be most of
them. Yeah. That would be.
I think I'm good.
Did you have something?
Yeah, just sorry, one other thing. So this pay-as-you-go list for 800K, is that going to be a separate discussion one evening?
Yeah, yes. Yeah. Okay. I want to go through the operating budget, then go to that stuff after.
All this cash, and we're just going to go out and buy stuff because we have all this cash. So let's see what it is.
I think that's fairly much not the case, but we'll go through it in detail.
Thank you.
Mr. Catino.
I want to thank all the departments really tried holding the line because after... The big spending that we did last year, there were a lot of people that really wanted to be as tight as possible. And I agree with Mr. Herr about the stabilization fund. And even putting as much money into the open, it's important to, if we have to tax the people more than save, I think we should just, it's conservative. And are we also being conservative on the new growth number?
I think the message, plain and simple, is we see that number normalizing in the coming year. The legacy farms and the new coming online that we've been at 1.5 million a year, go down back to the 700,000 and 800,000. So we are conservative.
Excellent.
No, I'm okay.
You good?
I'm good.
Okay. Mr. Starry.
Thank you, sir. First of all, Chris and Norman, fantastic job, and everybody else who was involved, the department heads as well. But I know that when push comes, ones who have to sit there and answer the questions and present all the numbers in a bundled form. I'll say that I was getting very nervous coming to this point. I made mention to Mr. Seem that the last each year we had less and less available budget before the date that we had to vote and turn things over to appropriations. So I was becoming concerned. However, I also the fact that be able to come out here, you need to be able to stand behind the numbers, and most importantly, well, you need to be able to talk to them. And for us to have you do anything otherwise would be irresponsible on our part as well. So thank you very much. I find this to be incredibly complete, very comprehensive. I think over the last, I've been on the board for 7 years now, this has really kind of the best of several presentations that we've had. Just so you know, as we go forward, whether it's from week to week or year to year, I personally like to see consistency in the form so that we can go back and from one year to another. That said, now I'll get to just a couple of questions. And one of them was, what was our excess levy capacity coming into the year?
Actually, it doesn't work that way. It's not like a balance, if you will. It's just the gap. What we're mandated to stay under and what we actually raised.
Right. And, so, and what was that, I guess, from last year?
Last year it was 1.4.
And at the end of this proposed budget, we're close to 1.6.
Correct.
So, okay, great. I'm seeing that, I think you spoke to this directly, like our receipts and available decreased by 1 million this year, but you were speaking to the enterprise funds and how that held the majority of that decrease?
Yes, if you remove enterprise from the top of the equation and the bottom of the equation, mm-hmm. which they are self-balancing, you are left... and you remove community preservation fund, which only has to spend, so in essence, you remove those components and add up the remaining years, and they're within each other.
Okay, great. More specific to a few of the line items. Now, Mr. Camallo, you had mentioned that there were a It sounded like there were a number of departments where you'd like to see some part-time employees, and you know, it may have just been verbally, but it sounded like there were more than one that were part-time administrative assistants. You know, as we're thinking about that type of, you know, if we're economy and hiring one full-time person and having them split their time, you know, I'd like to see us consider that. But, you know, only if it comes at greater economy. One of the bigger numbers that jump out at me, though, was the increase. And in the budget, I think it was about a little over a $600,000 number, which, you know, equates to a bit over 6%. I also heard in the presentation by Chris, I believe, that has the potential to go high. Is that correct?
That is correct. In fact, without compromising the town's negotiating position, as well protecting the privacy of the employees, great in our negotiations until about a month ago. At that time, three substantial showed up. That's where the discussion is. Mm-hmm. In terms of how we account for those three massive cases.
And I guess this number's big to be, it's over $9 million annually. Is there a process that we go through to knowing that we're getting the best option?
Yes, in fact, we have used a three-pronged strategy. Everyone will tell you that it's illegal to do a long-term plan for your health insurance. We're successful in doing that in our negotiation. That's the big picture perspective. The second step being, when it's appropriate to the community, we do an RFP process. The third piece is, we're constantly looking for opportunities to enhance benefits without increasing the cost to the taxpayers. So those are the three steps that we take. There have been suggestions in the past, and we tried this before, where in the instance of using the RFP process, we have multiple doing that on behalf of the town. God really. However, that's an option we still can look into.
Bless you.
Bless you.
We were looking great until recently.
That was subtle.
This issue came up, and that in itself took away the RFP option.
RFP process to get a PIC?
We, as part of this process, we compare our numbers and benefits with GIC.
Okay, great. And I know that we have only another minute or two to open up another meeting, but One of the recommended initiatives, and I guess I don't want to get into an in-depth conversation because I think it's going down the line, are requesting to construct a and design an asphalt initiatives to be funded through excess levy capacity. Could you just walk me through the process that you're envisioning for that in terms of funding requirements, requirements for votes and things of that nature?
Yes. I think first and foremost, I'm identifying these two projects as having community-wide benefits. So rather than having a single champion, this town boards, town committees come together and spearhead this effort. As part of that process, suggesting that we look into the excess levy funding a source. I'm also always mindful of the great work that this community has done in as well as finding mitigation from projects to offset the cost of the project. So let me focus on if we went with the excess levy option. The process will step one, the number is then included in the budget.
This is just pay as isn't? No.
Outside this 2.6.
It will be outside the 2.63. It will be at that $1 million number that is identified as the excess levy in source.
So to do that, essentially, wouldn't you be putting it into the operating budget?
Yes.
Okay.
You'll have to.
I mean, that for me, that's a no-starter. That's a no-starter. This isn't, those aren't operating expenses. Those are expenses, and in my mind, what that's doing is it's raising our baseline each year. Whereas, you know, a situation like last year when the discrepancy between the excess capacity and what our actual baseline was so great that the town decided to do an underwrite. And I think that what we're doing is put something like that into the operating budget. You know, it's been said many times, I know, by Mr. Palais, when we look at things, that it's starting to raise that base. And then all of a sudden when those debts or those requirements fall off the table, we start the base up there. And that's what I can support.
Yes. To be clear. We will not suggest the full cost of the project in that manner. There are aspects of the project as one-time cost. If design is 25 grand, why bother? That's the thinking. So remember, when we define our operating budget, debt service. That's why I say operating budget. I wasn't suggesting.
Yeah,
that.
And I know that we need to stop the meeting.
I do, yeah. I want to talk about why, right, this can't go in the operating budget. We should talk about it as pay-as-you-go, because if we had the money. At the end of the day, it's the same thing, right? But it sits outside the budget. Okay, what I'm going to do is I'm going to open this public hearing, and then we're going to continue it for 10 minutes or so we can finish up this, let the appropriations and school committee folks ask their questions, and then we're going to move on. Being 8 o'clock, posted public hearing, the hospital incorporates on-premises license application. The proponent, Hopkins and Center for the Arts, Incorporated, Kelly Grill Manager, locations 98 Hayden Row Street. The board will open a public hearing to consider approval of a new application for an all-alcohol general on-premises alcohol license. Chair will entertain a motion. Open the
moved.
Second. Motion, second. All
aye.
Okay, that's unanimous. The chair is going to continue the public hearing for the moment. Let's sit on this and see if we can get through the operating first. Sir, we'll just call. Okay. Do you have any more questions?
I just want to wrap up and say that I do have same wish, I guess, or desire as Mr. Mosier to start deeper with respect to the current turf field and what the financing looks like behind that. I think that before we start undertaking another endeavor, we need to be sure that we're planning and because we know that, you know, there's that, whatever it is, 10, 12, 15 years that we need to manage the field itself. And on that note, I also think that the town needs to be taking a look at what's being said on a national level about these fields and the health effects of people who play on them. And you know, I'm not going to start being Chicken Little and that, you know, all of a sudden we're going to have laws, but we at least need to start considering and taking a look at it, because it's not going away from the news. We just hear more and more stories as the months go on. So,
quick questions. Capital Asset Management Plan. We put this in place a few years ago. We said we're going to make sure we find and stuck to it. Is that been referenced in relation to this budget?
Yes. In fact, there's one building for the CIC, and did not recommend that building.
Okay. How about from the maintenance perspective, all the required maintenance on buildings and everything else? Are we funding that fully this year?
Yes, that's accounted for in the facilities budget.
Okay. But it is in fact fully accounted for. All the required maintenance is being done.
Yes, and in fact, when Dave proposed that...
Okay. Him to the list of people to come in next week and discussion. I just want to know the status of the structures. You know, what we're going to do on the... we can't, you know, we've seen this movie before. I don't want to go back there. Parks and Rec general fund subsidy last 2 years. I note there's no subsidy noted this year. Does that mean it's not going to be there?
As I said, beginning the discussions, depending on what we receive tomorrow.
So there's a swing factor there that could come into play for next week. Okay, so we're going to make sure we cover that in the next... I don't know if I had anything else. Otherwise, I will say it's an exceptionally well-done budget. I mean, it's not... I mean, you all did a great presentation on it. The document itself is very well done. I got kind of a list of things for next time to go through. It's remarkably nice. Let me go over to appropriations first. Questions, comments. Let's try to keep it short so we can sort of move along. But you know, budget tonight and whatever you want to talk about, go ahead.
Okay, so I too was a great. I just wanted to make a couple of comments about the stabilization fund. Just from the town's financial policy that we're supposed to be our guideline, it is supposed to be 5% of our operational stabilization fund. That is a goal. I think we should try to keep to it up as we're approaching 80%, where it should be 4 million. A few years ago it was 3 million. So we're still quite underfunded in that area. So we should keep funding that. The OPEB, I do have question, but my first comment is, you said you're using free cash for it. Long-term goal to try to work it into the. This is, you know, we had a whole study done. We should be putting this much in towards the OPEB. It's not saving for the future. This is an obligation for the employees working today. The cost of having these employees to contributing, and it really should be a budget, not necessarily. Hey, we have cash this year. Let's put some extra money in there, but we don't do it working its way in. My question to you regarding the operational budget is it's at $612,000. Typically we were looking around the $400,000 working its way down over. Is there a reason that has to be at $612,000 versus the $400,000?
A quick answer through the chair. We realize that we still have approximately 214,000 from prior years, and there's only 397,000.
Okay.
That's the invest in terms of the long term. We have a number for the pay-as-you-go component of that, and that is what brings us up to approximately 600,000.
Okay, thank you. And the final comment or question is, I'm trying to go through the sheet and I'm trying to figure out the overall, you know, tax impact, including exclusions. And I don't see anywhere in the budget. Like, I'm thinking down the road, we have a backlog of a school, a DPW, and a library. And at some point, we're going to start paying the debt exclusions. Are those worked into the projections going through 18, 19, and 20? Because I do see, like, next year, you see a 7%, you know, it's kind of a rough model, but I see a growth is 2018 when all these projects are going to start paying for them as we. That's my question. Into this presentation, the debt exclusion.
The debt is fully accounted for within budgets going through to 2000 on the current debt schedules that I have. The only point I was trying to make earlier was if any new items come on board, there's no way to now predict that. So these are hard numbers for debt schedules.
Okay, so even though you don't have a debt exclusion, that's part of the on your line item?
Debt exclusion only means that we can go up to 2.5 and still became necessary. I'm not sure I'm answering your question, though.
Yeah,
it doesn't look like it.
We'll talk about it in a couple of weeks. It's more, you know, how are we calculating the excess levy capacity? You know, I know it's, you take in how you do the calculation, but you have to exclusion, subtract that, and there's a I'm trying to find all the numbers, and I don't see a line item with the debt exclusion.
That's added to your levy limit. It actually has the effect of limit, which increases distance in your excess capacity, if you will, from the actual number to what we're allowed.
I'll go through the worksheet with you.
Connected. We'll do this. Well, let's do that. Let's go through the debt schedule separately. we're not connecting. Okay. Oh, okay.
Oh. Okay. So I just had a follow-on, and it's probably when the schools actually come to appropriation, is did the schools also follow the level services request for the initiatives and the costs associated? And then what were the costs? What are the costs going to be, and that can be when you guys come to us as well, of the town manager initiatives. Once we see a little further what those costs will be. And then the final thing I just wanted to say was the senior citizen tax relief that we talk about. I know it's been starting to get worried, especially with the debt coming years, and the threshold for qualifying for C has not increased since it was implemented. So I'd like to start to have the towns so that our seniors get almost like a COLA with qualifying if possible or for whatever reason.
Go ahead.
Yes. It's information. John Nist, the principal assessor and the point person on this project, we are looking at how other towns have addressed this issue and following up on a suggestion that town meeting.
Good. Schools. Any?
For the school committee, we don't have any questions about the operating budget. We did have the same questions that Mr. Sestari had, and just things of clarification, capital recommendations for funding source. Sounds like that's to be addressed.
Yeah. Next time. Do you have an answer to Pam's question? For you all specifically. Do we have anybody from CIC here asking questions? Okay. All right, so that's it for the first pass for tonight. So next week, let's, here's my to-do list. To have the Parks and Recs folks come in and talk about their budget in great detail, including all their revolving funds and such. I'd like to see how about the pavement management plan a little bit. I'm concerned that we have a lot of subdivisions that are getting old, and I'm worried about next few years, and I just like to understand how he's thinking where it goes.
Can I answer that piece?
Of course.
We actually tentatively scheduling the management discussion for the 20th, isn't it?
But that's after.
What date did we agree to?
It wasn't until April, because...
Because that takes Chapter 70 is what you're taking, or Chapter 90, rather. You're taking Chapter 90 money for that.
Okay,
we usually do it then, I agree. Can we just, I just want to hear him come in and give a high level state of the, basically your state of the roads address. Okay, so let's just, because the roads are starting to get worn, or they're going to get years. Public Works, you're going to come in and also talk about the stormwater, right? That's next week as well. And then, I can't read my own handwriting here. Oh, maintenance. We're going to have Dave come structures and everything else. We're going to cover next week, we're going to cover the capital projects request summary, right? So, and we're into that. Turf field and the. Can we make sure we have some detail? I'll come back to that. Can we make sure we have some detail from the schools on some of these, like system-wide security, complex thing in years past? Can you all kind of come in and give a lengthy discussion of the specific ties into the larger plan, right? Because we spend a lot of money on that every year. Mr. Katina, the part-time help. What is it?
Mr. Sestari. I like things verbally.
Okay. Initiatives. Can we get the reconciliation free cash number asked about, right?
Yeah.
And then anything else, please?
Cool question tonight, but I'm interested in hearing from everybody. Any department or department head that has an initiative or a concern about the budget as it stands.
Okay, so next week we'll do.
Speak now or forever. Yeah. Not now, okay. But soon.
Yeah, speak next week or forever hold your peace. Anybody, anything else? Anyone wants addressed? Okay, good. So that's our to-do list. Finish up on the operating budget, and we'll do capital, and then we'll wrap the rest of the stuff up on the screen so we can send this off, and then we'll do the that. Is moving right along here. We're going to go back to item 8.5 on the agenda, which is the posted public hearing for the Hopkins Center for the Arts Incorporated, Section 12, General On-Premises License Application. So, summary from my perspective, HCA would like to be able to hold events of various kinds at the Hopkins Center for the Arts and is asking for a liquor license. 12, which means not a restaurant liquor license, in conjunction, right, to support those activities. Kelly?
Yes.
All right, so why don't you, and then we'll...
Mr. Chair.
The parties here to talk
Chair.
About it, and then we'll go
yep.
from there. Yes?
Might I suggest that we just explain what this is and how this is going to work for everyone in
okay.
terms of...
So let me...
So
yeah.
Everyone knows
okay, so we got a lot of folks here, surprisingly. So... Okay, everybody, so this is a public hearing. It's a formal public hearing. It's actually a legally defined process. And so the way we're going to do it is the applicant comes up about what they propose to do, goes to the board, which can then ask them questions about it. Then what we typically try to do is we'll go out to interested parties. We'll get those in favor want to come up. We'll get those who are opposed who want to come up. And then we'll sort of work our way through all that. Then at some point when... Like we sort of public hearing, the board then deliberates. So we're going to try to get through it tonight. If we bog down, we may not get through it tonight, but we will give it our best shot. In terms, since there's a lot of folks here who want to come up and say something, general rules are you come up to the podium, you know, name and address, try to keep it on point. I apologize in advance if I interrupt you, but if we wander off topic or if we go long, we're just going to have to indicate comments. That.
Thank you.
Welcome.
My name is Kelly Grill, and I am the co-director of the Hopkins Center for the Arts and also record on our application, which is why we're here tonight. As most of you know, the Hopkins Center for the Arts is a nonprofit arts center which offers classes in visual art, performing arts, dance. We also have performance opportunities in all of those areas, film and lectures to our list of selections in the coming years. We have recently met with school superintendent, the school committee, and also the department regarding this license, and we have addressed those concerns, and we look forward to speaking to them to address any additional concerns that they have. And we simply wanted to say for the arts has for at the forefront the health and well-being of its youth, of the citizens of, and that's evident in some of the programs that we offer, like Art Space, school creative outlet for middle school students as an alternative after school. We've worked closely with Denise Hildreth on this project. We're looking to grow that project and offer it. We offer Space to Be Free, which is an organization, again, an alternative organization in the high school to have the coffee house for the arts and other free programming, the Respite Center for continue to offer those programs as well as many opportunities for cultural events at the center. We are very proud of the work that has been done that the beautiful in the town, and we are really proud of the reputation and the mission that we have developed 4 or 5 years that we've been on the property. And we plan to make the community proud to have the part of our community for generations to come. And with that said, I would like to introduce Joseph, who is a founding member of both the Hopkins Community Endowment and the Hopkins to talk further about the license.
Thank you, Kelly. Thank you, Mr. Chairman, members of the board. I think it would behoove all of us here tonight to begin perhaps with some clarification. Feel maybe some misinformation that's flying around out there, and try to get it clear for this hearing exactly what we're trying to accomplish here tonight. The application process for a liquor license that you operating hours as if you were a normal establishment. And when that faced us when we were filling out the application, it put us in a bit of a quandary because we have no operating hours. What we're looking to do is to apply for a liquor license only for events sponsored by the HCC, production, an art gallery opening. So what has led to some misunderstanding is we bracketed the hours in which any possible events could take place. And that has been misinterpreted that we would be serving alcohol during all those hours, which we have no intention of doing. But we tried to cover the operating hours because if we had an event that was outside of the stated operating hours, we could have been turned down to serve alcohol at that particular event. So I hope that clarifies one point that's out there that has been a little bit misconstrued. So for example, if we show a 12 o'clock noontime till 10 o'clock on a Saturday, we would be serving alcohol only for perhaps a play that's on there for 3 hours, from 7 to 10. So those operating hours would never be fully utilized. So we, the HCA, the applicant, are appealing to the Board of Selectmen to condition this permit, to state that the permit is only good for events sponsored by the HCA at the Hopkinen Center for the Arts. And I think that may help clarify some of the issues that are out there. Today we had the privilege of meeting with Chief Lee and Lieutenant Porter to get the police department's concerns with regard to this. And it was a very beneficial dialogue for us. And one of the things that came up, and this comes up in any contract negotiations, is we have to negotiate the contract as if the personalities in this room didn't exist. So we may have great trust back and forth here, but a generation from now, whatever's written down in that permit is what's going to survive. And the concern that came about from the police department, and I think a valid one, was it's showing 12 to 10. And so you can tell us here that this is this, but it could conceivably go for 10 hours. So we would like to ask the board to consider in the issuing of this permit a further restrictive condition that the applicant is requesting. And that condition is that alcohol not be served for any HCA function for a duration longer than 4 hours or 5 hours if it happens to be a wedding. I don't know why, but that's what they told me was appropriate. So I wanted to say that.
Try to keep the pair from going broke.
We are hopeful that by requesting these limiting conditions that the mission of the HCA remains paramount and forefront as a cultural center for arts, not as a tavern, as someone has written. We are simply doing this as a means to supplement
the activities that we are offering to the community at large. The third item that has come up, and I think a valid question, is why don't you just go for one-day permits? Why don't you just go for one-day permits and you will issue them and you come and you do that? So let me explain that so that people really understand why that's not a good alternative. I believe one-day permits are limited to 30 a year. Secondly, when you get a one-day permit, you also have to get a one-day insurance policy, which is very expensive. So if you stop and think about this for a minute, if ESL is putting on a show two consecutive weekends, Friday, Saturday, and Sunday, we need six permits and six insurance policies. I don't care how successful the bar is, you have no profit. This was verified for us by our good friends at our sister organization at TCAN and the wonderful David LaValle, who has been tremendously helpful to us. And he said when they went the one-day route for many years and it just wasn't worthwhile. Not only that, but we are a lean organization with a highly dedicated but lean administrative staff. You put this burden on every time we want to do something. We have to go for a permit. We have to contact an insurance company. We have to pay for that insurance company for Friday night, a separate one for Saturday night, a separate one for Sunday. It makes no sense. The good people in the government of Natick saw fit to go to the legislature and seek a special permit for TCAN, a full liquor license. And they have that, and they are running. And suffice it to say, TCAN's revenue from the alcohol license increased by 450%. So yes, one-day permits are theoretically possible, but they do not make financial sense. And that leads me into my next point. We've been at this for a while now. The original members of the HCA board, we've researched, we've hired business consultants, we have an enormously wonderful business plan. Every arts organization that we talked to around the country said, you must have multiple streams of revenue. If you are going to be more than a flash in the pan, if you are going to be a sustainable, viable arts organization, you must generate revenue from multiple sources. This liquor license is not the heart and soul of the HCA. It is simply one of a patchwork quilt of revenue sources that we need to be sustainable and viable. We have worked very hard on our facility to make sure that we are sustainable and viable. We have an enormously successful solar program that allows us to keep our utility bills down. We have insulated the heck out of that building. We have done everything we can do to try to make this organization sustainable. So when you look at it and you understand that this is one piece of our revenue puzzle, it makes sense. If you stop and think about it, we have been, I think, model citizens, the HCA, in terms of cooperative ventures. I know of no public-private venture that has been this successful. People look at that facility and they say, this organization must be very wealthy. We emptied the coffers of the HCE to build that building. For 18 years, a generation, people of Hopkinton, the people of Hopkinton paid their property taxes, people who did everything they were supposed to do, then reached further into their pockets to fulfill the mission of the HCE, which was to improve the quality of life in this community. They did it before we had a project. And then we had a project, and they continued to do it. We were blessed to receive CPC money from the town to help us restore the barn. That CPC money constituted 16% of our construction budget. 84% of our construction budget came from the citizens of Hopkinton, who spoke loudly and clearly with their pocketbooks that they wanted this to happen, that this was something that was going to improve the quality of life in Hopkinton. When you go to the center now and you see the residents of the Respite Center in one of their drama classes just having so much fun, or you go to one of the photography classes that we put on for Alzheimer's patients, and for one moment, you see that lucid clarity that was part of their life earlier. And when you see a six-year-old take their first watercolor class or an adult taking their first tap dance class, you understand what is happening there is viable and beneficial and important. The arts are important. The arts matter. We have the opportunity with this facility to do something that will be the envy of everybody in this region. We have met with the school committee. We have met with Superintendent McLeod. We've met with the police department. We have demonstrated with our work with the planning department over the years that we play well together. We work hard. We listen to our neighbors. And we work in a neighborly fashion. We are on a mission. And we have come halfway. We are now 6 months old into our operation in this new facility. It is challenging every day. Meeting payroll is challenging. Keeping the lights on is challenging. When you stop and think about what Natick did for its Center for the Arts, this organization is self-funding. We do not go to town meeting and ask for tax dollars to support our operations. But what we are doing tonight is we're coming in front of you and we're asking you to do what Natick did. We're asking you to recognize the validity of what we're doing, to recognize that we are responsible citizens and that we will carry out this obligation as great stewards in the community. And furthermore, we're asking you to allow us a revenue stream that will lend credibility and viability and sustainability to the Hopkinton Center for the Arts. Thank you.
Chuck. Okay. Why don't we get some factual input here? Chief, can you come on up and I'm sure people are going to ask your opinion. Do we have anybody from the school committee here still? Did they all leave? They got what they're getting was good? Okay. We have a letter from the school committee, a fairly legal letter that says they find the HCA premises as defined are not detrimental to the educational activities of the school. So there's a letter on file from them. Chief, can you talk about what you think about all this?
Just let me start by saying I've 28 years in law enforcement, and most of my career has been community policing, obviously an emphasis on public safety. So when something like this comes across my desk, of course, that's what my major concern is, actually my only concern. Obviously, it's a wonderful center over there. They're doing a lot of great things. That was an excellent presentation. But my concerns are the kids and public safety, people consuming alcohol, getting into their vehicles, sharing a lot with the school department is a serious concern. We need to make sure that we're covering everything. As I said in my comments, earlier in the agenda, I've certainly supported them in the past when they've come to us and to have events. I like the idea. I know it's maybe an inconvenient or a price, but the idea to me is that we can all take a look at it and we can decide on an event-by-event thing. And I know that they'll be probably very stringent of keeping things safe. But there's a lot of question. You know, I know there'll be a secure police for the alcohol, but you mentioned there's going to be a lot of children in that area during the day, taking classes, and there's always the possibility of someone having access to that. The biggest thing is on the school campus, and everything has to do with location, because it's at that location and it shares with the school. We do a lot of work with the kids. And one of the biggest things is trying to find other activities for kids other than going out on a Friday night or after a basketball game or a function or a house party to do something and telling them, you know what, this whole world isn't about going out and having a good time by consuming alcohol in this case or drugs in this obviously our message on drugs. But our whole point is to get that message across. And, you know, I would hate to think that we're sending a wrong message to the youth in this community to enjoy yourself, have a good time, or be a successful venue. Alcohol has to be a part of it. So that's just one of the messages that we're always constantly working in this town and trying to get that message out to kids to prevent tragedies happening in this community. But like I said before, public safety is a key issue. There's things listed down there as weddings. You've got a few hundred people at a wedding. I've been to a pretty couple crazy weddings in my day, and people filing out of the parking lot, things of that nature is a concern for us. So We certainly had a great conversation today. They seem very, very willing to work. But just in my opinion, I just don't feel that it is a necessary thing, and I don't think we'd be setting the tone for our brand in the community, and especially our message to the kids. So at this point, while I think we have a pretty good system in place now, and even though I'm not 100% comfortable on an event-by-event thing, I think we have more control over that. I think alcohol would be brought in on an event, wouldn't be stored there. So I would respectfully decline at this point.
Thank you, Chair. Do we have anyone else from the permitting team who has any comments to make?
Elaine.
Yes, sir.
Denise Hendler is here. She's the Director of Youth and Family Services.
Denise, do you want to come up and give your thoughts?
Good evening. So I did have a chance to speak with Kelly this morning at length about this. I do not have concerns about this going forward the way that it is. I think that I have great trust in Kelly and the team, that this would be, that it's well thought, that it's responsible, and that it would not pose a particular risk to our youth. So that's where I stand.
Thank you. Okay. Any other town employees to talk? Yes, go ahead. Huh? Yeah, no.
Ed Wharton and Board of Health, Mr. Chairman. Ours is kind of an ancillary issue with respect to the operation, in that in our regulations, any beverage is considered a food. So that triggers a requirement to meet all the aspects of the food code, which would necessitate having some type of facilities to clean, sanitize the utensils, glassware that's being utilized. So I would follow Kelly's comment that her interest is the health and well-being of the community. That's our reason to exist. So I would make that note, and if the board is reviewing this, that they should consider that they also have the proper facilities to operate food.
So let's just talk about the mechanics of how that works, right? So we don't, that's a Board of Health determination, right? So you all would have to inspect it, I guess, and determine it's appropriate for the use, right?
Right.
That's separate from the licensing process.
I think in terms of, if you look at the lease, Mr. Chairman, that provision is in there, that compliance with all other state, federal requirements and the regulations that we had, we would enforce as we do with everyone in town. So it is separate in this sense, but I would presume that as part of the operation of that facility and the lease that they have, that they would have to comply with.
No, that's not the. I agree with you. That's not. I guess it wasn't clear. That wasn't what I was saying. What I'm trying to understand is, I think historically we've issued licenses without reference to the Board of Health's inspection or determination of the premises as being acceptable, right? Because sometimes we issue licenses and things aren't even built. So I'm just trying to say, let's just talk about the order of operations here, right? So we don't need to give a license contingent on a determination by the Board of Health that it's usable. That's a separate thing where you all, if we give the license, when the time comes for them to try to implement, right, to try to use it, right, you have to come in and give an opinion that the facility is qualified to serve food, right, which includes alcohol.
Well, I would presume that we would advise the applicant that would be the intent, that they
right.
would, while not directly involved with the Board of Health now, that they would, in fact, seek that
right.
approval.
But all I'm trying to say is that doesn't necessarily impact whether or not we give them a license, because that's an entirely separate process, right? Historically, it's always been.
Well, it would be, but again, I think if you look at the lease,
mm-hmm.
We heard reference of Natick. Natick selectmen require of food with any alcoholic beverage serving that they have in the community. The permit that they reference actually has a concession that's associated with that.
But that's a whole different topic. I'm talking about the Board of Health inspection, right, that says that they meet the requirements of the Board of Health.
Correct.
Which is what you're talking about, I think, right? You're going to have to go inspect them at some point.
Well, I would have to approve whatever they plan to.
Right, which correct. Is going to, right. But that's utterly separate from the licensing decision of whether or not they can hold a license.
Well, I would agree with that.
Okay.
They could conceivably progress. Be in the position that yeah. the selectman issued a license and that we couldn't issue them a permit to operate. That's
that correct. I agree with completely. Right. So that's, so we're saying the same thing.
Yeah,
so
he has full authority to do what he's got to do.
I totally get that. Right. I'm just trying to make clear to everyone else so everyone gets it, the fact that these are, you know. Correct. Right. Just because we give a license doesn't mean they're good to go. There's still a whole other process they have that's to correct. Go through with you. But again, in terms of order operations, how we've always done it, we give people licenses and then they sort of work through the rest of what they're doing. Because again, it's not always, we've given licenses, like I said, when the building wasn't even built yet.
Grill.
Yeah. Okay. Okay, good. Anything else, Ed?
No, that's it.
Thank you very much. Chairman. Okay. Okay, we good on town, folks? No? Town employees now? Okay, over to the board for questions. Mr. Mosier, why don't we start with you?
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Actually, I do have a question for Elaine Lazarus around the Zoning Advisory Committee. So I was going through the minutes of the Zoning Advisory Committee from 2013. Water Fresh Farm had petitioned for a change in zoning to support events very similar to some of the ones that are proposed in this letter, and I believe that vote failed at town meeting also, right? I believe the Zoning Advisory Committee recommended against it, and that petition also failed at town meeting?
It did. The Planning Board also recommended against it.
Okay. All right, thanks. Just want to make sure I was recalling the details of that right. Minutes were accurate, all that sort of thing. So I guess from my standpoint, it's not just about the alcohol, it's also about the type of events and zoning consistency with that location, with residents around that location. So as it sits right now, I'm not in favor of it, of the license.
Okay. No other questions for them?
No.
Okay. Mr. Hurry, got any questions?
So the public hearing process is designed to get as much information out as possible so that we can make some decisions based on a lot of information. So please don't read into my questions. But I'm going to rapid fire a bunch here, if that's okay with the chair, to specific individuals that have already spoken. Kel, you mentioned you're going to be the manager of record. Do you have any experience being the manager of record on an alcohol license?
Not an alcohol license, but I have been manager of personnel agency for 15 years, and also worked in hospitality and have been the manager of the license.
So it's my understanding, as the manager of record on a within a facility where the license is held, you have certain requirements that you have to meet per the state, where you'll have to take classes and so forth and become certified to be that manager of record.
Yes.
You okay with that? You understand? And there's a lot to that. It's not having managed people prior. This is about managing alcohol and managing safety and all kinds of other things. So you'll have to go through that process to be, I think, certified to be, or allowed to be a manager of record. I don't think she has to have it for us to approve it, but she's got to have it. I would think we'll have to check with this. She's going to have this certification in order to issue, actually hand them the license. Can we check on that?
Just to be clear, the Board of Selectmen also approved the money
along with the license.
Right. So we're assuming she's qualified,
think,
or would be.
Yeah, I think just we're.
Okay, so, well, we have required that all other managers of record that we've issued license to in the last several years have all these certifications. So we've got to make sure that that takes place as part of this process. We don't have to necessarily do this tonight. We have to get ready to do this if we're going to do it. You know what I'm saying? So I think that's something we have to consider and talk further about, sounds like. We can't give her a license having no experience whatsoever in managing an alcohol distributing facility and make require that everyone else does. Right? So I'm just throwing it out there. Mm-hmm. So with the license and the manager of record comes liability. So and these conversations we have, folks, about alcohol are always a little bit tense, so just hang in there with us because this is some serious stuff. So Kelly, with that manager of record on the license comes a lot of liability, not only for the HCA, but for you personally.
Yes.
So I think you have to understand that and consider that and be ready for that. Okay? So...
Yes.
Okay. So your insurance company's going to have to cover you as well as the organization. So weddings, big topic. I can't remember the last wedding I went to that wasn't a lot of fun. And I can't remember the last wedding I wasn't at that some 22-year-old did something silly. So weddings, I think, are a serious concern and something we probably need to talk about some more. Are weddings a must-do for you folks?
It's hard to say weddings specifically. We're seeing there seems to be a need for weddings permits for other parties, but every event that we have, we apply by all the agency licensing and have some certified staff available based on how many people were attending.
Weddings are going to be an issue for me, just so you know. I was 22 once, too, so been there, done that. I just think there's a lot of people in the community concerned about weddings.
Mr. Herr, we would not let weddings stop this license. If that became an insurmountable objection, we would look at that with you, and we would consider not having them. It's here in front of you now because people have come to us and said, this is what we would like to do. But we do want to have the opportunity to lease that property for private functions. If you determine as a board and condition the license and say we are going to exclude weddings, we would certainly honor that.
So I had a question jotted down, excuse me, limits of uses included in the license, and then Chuck, you spoke to a bunch of the things that you would like to see sort of limiting in the license, so I appreciate that. You mentioned that, you know, we're talking about for the next 20 years talking about this permit and so forth. This is a one-year license, and every year it gets renewed. So you can have a one-year license, it can go great, and we can renew it. You can have a one-year license, it can be miserable for everybody, maybe including yourselves, and we don't renew it. So you can't build your business model assuming you're going to get a one-year license every year. I think there's a reasonable expectation, if it's managed well, that the community, because this board changes as well, you know, we all change out, that the community would continue to support something if it's done right. If it's not done right, license actually can be pulled mid-year, can be pulled immediately, but we also don't have to renew it every year. So this is a one recurring process that goes on year after year. another tough question, but I think it's legit. Will anyone profit, receive a commission, or a bonus against liquor sales?
No. No. This is money that goes into the HCA operating budget.
Okay. And you mentioned the construction budget, Chuck, and the public funds were at 16%. Does that include the original foundation work and all that was done to stabilize
the
barn?
No, it does not. That includes, I believe, $365,000 that the HCA was the recipient of when we became the HCA as an entity. There were monies expended before that for the foundation work to which you're referring.
Which were about, if my memory serves me correctly, right around $500,000.
I don't have any idea what that's.
Yeah, I was on that committee. It was a lot of money. So just as an FYI, folks, this is not just a 16% public investment. It's probably closer to a 40% public investment, something along those lines. So
more than that.
Just something people need to understand and be aware of. Okay, so not reading into my questions. Thank you for your time.
Good. Thank you, Mr. Arp. Mr. Sestari.
Thanks. I want to see this happen in some form or fashion. I do have concerns about it, and I have some questions. I guess one of the things, Mr. Herr hit on it with the private events, I think, and the weddings. It's definitely a concern of mine. I was kind of thinking that it was off the table when Chuck mentioned that this would be for events sponsored by the HCA, because I guess in my definition, that kind of takes the private events off the table. But that would definitely be one of the stipulations I'd be looking for. Another concern of mine is, I think it was our last meeting, we started talking about, or it was a continuation of a discussion around liquor licenses, both for restaurants as well as for liquor sales from stores. And during one of those last couple of meetings, I know it came up that basically, once a license is issued, we have little control over the actual hours that business can be done.
Liquor stores.
That's what I wanted to clarify was that. But still, to that end, You know, we're talking about, and I understand the necessity to have some hours on a liquor license.
Right.
So then we're looking at this situation where we've got some hours out there, and who's to define an event versus just, you know, an everyday kind of passing through the center. So I feel as though we somewhat lose, for lack of a better word, I'm going to say authority. Not that I'm looking for authority over every event that you're doing, but we lose any control over those hours that we might discuss in general terms. So I guess what I'm wondering is there any way for us to issue a license, but then at the same time amend the lease agreement so that we have more legal controls over the times that and any other restrictions when things can actually happen. So there's the liquor license, which is pretty general, and it might say, you know, noon to midnight, and it might say, you know, noon to midnight Sunday through Saturday. But then maybe in the lease agreement we can put refined controls on there saying, you know, what the length of time is for any event, the maximum length of time, you know, or things of that nature.
Todd, I think we addressed that earlier when we asked that the liquor license be issued with a constraint that said no event could last more than 4 hours.
Yeah, and that makes me feel better, but yeah. I'm just not sure. I haven't heard from town council in terms of what the legality of that is and how enforceable that is. I just want something that is somewhat enforceable on our end. And then I think my last comment is, personally, I think I would feel better if this was something that was restricted to beer and wine as opposed to all alcohol. And everything else, you know, obviously they need to conform with the Board of Health, but I'd like to see this happen in some way, but we need to work through some of the details, I think.
Okay. Ms. Coutinho.
Yeah, I go in for Norman first. How many licenses do we have available for liquor for left?
And at this category, we only have 3 left.
Because I want to make sure that we have some for restaurants, for downtown revitalization and everything that we're still trying to do in the town. That was my first one. Are you able to have weddings now at the HC, or have there been any, or bat mitzvahs or anything?
We have 2 requests for this year, I think, for this summer.
And would you have been able to pull a one day? Would you pull one day for an event like that? Because I'm another, I'd like to see something happen. Because for the place to have another stream of revenue and be able to, you know, be more self-sustaining, this is a great thing. But I still have one more. So I was at my daughter dances, and she was at a dance competition at the DCU this weekend. And during that whole competition, they had no alcohol served at all. So I just want to make sure that if there are events that are children-oriented, even though there are a lot of adults there that were just bored as hell. I mean, it was tough at times, that there was still not a single beer with, actually even next door, the tavern next door was even closed. And I just want to make sure.
How many blocks did you have to walk?
We're in full agreement with that.
Yeah. Okay. And again, just to make sure that everybody is completely TIPS certified, the same as every That's other right. Establishment that we've been talking about with the liquor licensing.
Mr. Chairman, I just wanted to throw one other comment. I would prefer to also see there be some type of food requirement. You know, even if it's bags of chips or something like that are for sale, at least having some type of food that's available.
Okay. All right. Okay. Anything else? Over to me, I guess. So, Chuck, you've got 100 events a year proposed, ex the weddings and all.
Say again?
100, this list?
Yes.
This list is 100 events a year plus, you said, a dozen kind of other, you know, weddings and celebrations and stuff like that. So is that... Is that sort of an optimistic schedule?
Yes,
right, that's two
very,
a week, so right? So,
it's
I mean,
a very optimistic schedule.
You know, realistically, what are we looking at here?
Well, we're in the first 6 months of operation.
Yeah.
So what we tried to do in our application was to say, what's the most possible events we would have in a year, including plays, lectures, musical concerts, art shows? What would be the, and we don't know. To be honest with you, we really don't know. So I think after a year, because it's a one-year license, we would be able to say much more realistically what the number of events are most likely to be.
Right, right. Okay. And do you think, you know, there's a laundry list of things you might want to serve at. Do you realistically think you'd want to serve at all of them? Or,
no.
Or is this just you kind of want the leeway?
No, it's Chris Waldman and Kelly are the co-directors, and it's at their discretion as to what they say. It's like if there's an adult-only open mic on a Friday, that would probably be an event that we would serve at.
Right.
If there was an open mic for all ages, that would be an event we would not serve at.
Yeah.
All right, so we're not serving at all events. It's only those appropriate events.
Okay. And so can you talk a little further about that? Like, give me some of the criteria to think about what's an appropriate. So, right, so only if adults are there, I guess it makes sense.
Yeah.
How do you feel about it?
I would run an analogy to a restaurant. You know, when you go into a restaurant with a child, you're allowed to have a drink, and that's kind of the way it is. If you come to an adult play on a Friday night, for instance, we would probably serve, we would have the bar open before the event
and
an intermission, and then we'd shut it down.
Yeah.
One of the things David LaValle told us about TCAN is they don't serve any alcohol after the events because people leave.
Yeah.
This is not a bar that they're coming to hang around and drink at. That's not what this is, and that's not what the HCA is.
Yeah. Okay. How would we deal with overlapping school events? You know, what I really get worried about is a parking lot full of folks for something, right?
Sure.
A football game or you know, anything, right?
If,
how do we deal with that?
Yeah. I think it's important to understand the history of the cross-parking agreement that we have with the school department, which I negotiated with the previous superintendent. And basically what it is the school holds all the cards. It's their parking lot. So they come, we go to them every semester, and we say, what are the blackout dates? What do you have in your schedule that we cannot do anything? And they tell us, these are the dates you cannot have an event in the evening. We have parents' night. We have graduation. Whatever it is going to be where that parking lot is going to be full. There actually are not that many events where that parking lot is full. It is almost never full for a football game except for Thanksgiving Day. It's never full for a basketball game.
Yeah, you're going to parking. I'm going to, you know, a lot, you know, a mass of people in the vicinity and all this sort of going on, right? What I don't, you know, I said a parking lot full. I didn't mean full the capacity.
Yeah.
I just meant you got some school event going on.
Yes.
I don't know that I think that the overlap there is a good thing. And so what have, I mean...
We're in
I guess
coordination.
I want to say, yeah, from my perspective, I just want to separate these temporally, right? So we all kind of have our, this is going to be interesting because we all kind of have our touch points.
Yeah.
My touch point is having you not doing these kind of things the same evenings that there's something going on at the school or, you know, the days, whatever it is. And that's sort of my hang up. And would that be...
I think
acceptable?
We defer to that in the cross-parking agreement because they tell us what's off-limits. The school dictates to us what's off-limits.
Right, but...
So let me take it one step further, Ben. If there's an art gallery show and there's 50 people coming to an opening of an art gallery show and the band is having rehearsal at the high school, I don't see those as being mutually exclusive. I don't think any time there's an event where there's 20 kids practicing for basketball or something like that, that we have to not have anything at the HCA. We also have parking for 50 cars at the HCA. So we're talking about when we have a theatrical performance, a musical performance, or something that's larger.
Right. Okay. Again, I need to think about that one some more. I have extreme sensitivity to that.
Mm-hmm.
Right. The big. I mean, okay. At a high level, conceptually, I'm kind of okay with this. Right. It makes sense to me. You got an adult place. You want to have events. Right. You know, it's sort of. I don't have like any philosophical hang-ups with this. I just have some pragmatic hang-ups with this. You know, where I want people. I want. Again, because you're right next to the school, because you're in a residential neighborhood, right? We gotta not cause problems for all those folks. And so the my sensitive spots are you know, events at the school where there's a lot of folks there for something. I really, really don't want you doing it then. Mm-hmm. And then I'm kind of anxious about 100 events a year because that's, you know, a couple nights a week we're sort of infringing on people's lives. And so you tell me that's kind of conceptual. So maybe we have to figure that out in the first year.
Right.
But those are my personal sensitivities.
Fair enough.
Okay. And again, this isn't so much a driver for me, but I just want, because you brought it up and you made such a big deal, I want to understand, why is this so important from, I mean, how much is this of your budget is this going to provide? Is this really that meaningful to you?
We don't know yet.
What are you going to spend? I mean, so it's not to fund things you do now, it's to... How does this make it better? I mean, is it...
Sure.
I figured you're going to come in and tell me it's just because we want people to be able to enjoy themselves, which was a much easier conversation, but you took the hard way, so I'm going to make it...
and certainly that's part of it, but that's not the heart and soul of it. Yeah. If you look at, for instance, right now, I think many of you, and I'm not sure all of you, have been to the Center for the Arts, but you should go and visit it if you have not been there. It is a gem for this community. And what's happening is all the people who partake of this right now, senior citizens down to little kids and their parents, they see this facility and they're coming to us now and they all have 12 suggestions as to how we should expand programming. Oh, you should be offering this, you should be offering this. Look, we're trying to get through this year with the staff we have and do what we do well. Yeah. For us to expand, we have to expand staff. We have to expand staff. We do not have the revenue to expand staff, and we're not going to get that revenue from class dues. Part of what we're trying to do, or class tuition rather, what we're trying to do is to keep these classes affordable for all citizens in Hopkinton. And in order to do that, we have to control our budget and we have to have revenue streams. Stop and think about an art center. Try to, in your own head, if you're a business person, try to think, what are our sources of revenue here? How do we get enough to pay for this multi-million-dollar facility that we are now operating? This is one piece of a patchwork quilt.
Are you a 501c3? You must be.
Yes,
right?
We are.
Okay. Is there debt on the from this construction, or is that paid for? So it's debt-free.
It is debt-free.
So all the money you need, first of all, comes. Well, I will tell you, It sticks on me when you say how much it was funded by people who contributed, because the town contributed massively, to Mr. Hurst's point. So I just want to make clear. I'd appreciate if you'd give more credit to the town's contribution to going forward.
I tried to. Okay. All I could speak of were the CPC funds that I was involved with.
But we should know the math, because the math is big, right? The town did a chunk of money for this. But setting that aside, the operating budget is all to fund just activities. Like there's no, like you said, there's no debt, there's no something. It's just to expand.
That's correct.
Expand the offerings.
That's correct.
Okay.
One of the things also as part of our lease is we're responsible for all maintenance of that building.
Right.
It's a town-owned building.
I know that much.
But we are responsible for it.
Okay.
So, you know, these things, when you have limited resources, this is a challenge.
Okay. Yeah, I know. I get it. Yeah. Okay. One of the things we're going to have to work with. Yes, sir.
Whilst you're still on this topic, if I may, there's a question that has been asked in general of the office. Could you please explain the structure of the organization, specifically the relationship between the CAA, ESL and the foundation? I know you and I, one-on-one, we've gone through this many times, but the public is asking, what is the relationship?
Let me handle that. Yeah. Okay. All right, come.
Kelly, you got to go, because you don't get on TV otherwise, which I know you like.
I know, I love that. Yeah, the Hopkins Center for the Arts is the overarching organization, if you think of it that way. So Chris and I are the co-directors of the Hopkins Center for the Arts. Entrestage Left Theater is the resident theater company. It's a separate 501(c). It pays rent. It is housed there and does all of its productions now at the Hopkins Center for the Arts. That's their home. The Hopkinton Community Endowment, again, a separate 501(c), was the fundraising arm, and as Chuck said, depleted their funds to this project of the Hopkins Center for the Arts.
Okay.
CAA was the former organization. Right. Is that the question as well? CAA was the original organization that was housed there at the farmhouse and originally cordoned off that piece of land, started this whole project in the first place, and was there for 15 years. That organization dissolved, and that was primarily a volunteer organization. And then the Hopkins Center for the Arts was formed 5 years ago as a 501(c) and is now being run as a nonprofit business.
Okay, thank you.
Makes sense?
Good.
Thank you.
All right. So, okay, I have I'm making my to-do list of things we're going to have to answer here to move this ahead. Okay. I'm good on questions. So let's go to the public, and let me think about this. How should we do this first? Why don't we start with abutters? I mean, so folks who had to be legally notified for this. So any abutters here want to come up and talk to this project? Sir, any abutters, you know, come on up. You obviously need to talk. Hi.
Thanks, go ahead. Good evening, Mr. Chairman.
Welcome.
Members of the board. My name is Martin Bays. I'm the immediate butter. I live at 106 Hayden Row Street. I did submit written comments to the,
yes,
the board.
Oh, can I just stipulate? We got a lot of emails on this, and so I just want folks to know that we got them. Most of them are in the packet here. They got forwarded, so they've all been read. So,
surely,
but thank
understood.
You.
I wanted to emphasize a couple of points and note some of the comments made earlier this evening.
Okay.
I think the comment made about the sponsorship versus external events, I think that is an aspect that I would also strongly endorse, that I see a large difference between an organization running its own events and being responsible. I have great faith in the organization to do that. When people come in who are not part of the organization using it as a facility, I think that changes matters significantly. One of the aspects that I mentioned in my written comments that I think is important is the question of the hours to which any potential license might be issued to. I think that the hours as stipulated at the moment are too late. I think the mission of the organization could be adequately served by an earlier cutoff time. I think the description of many of the events that the folks from the center have described, I don't think it would be a burden to reduce significantly that. As an immediate abutter, the thought of midnight as a closing time for a significant size event is a significant concern for me.
Mm-hmm.
In my comments, I'd also ask the question about the number of people who would be at a single event. I'm not certain exactly how many that would be. I think it overlaps with your concern about the sharing of the site with the school events. One other aspect that's mentioned in the application is the possibility of having service at the patio area and the lawn area outside. And again, in the context of a facility that's located within school property, that I have very great reservations about. And again, I think that's an aspect the board could consider in terms of a stipulation. Service inside the building, I have absolutely no issue with. Whether it's a license in the form as requested or on an event basis, I have no major concern. I think the organization is well run. Their mission is well supported in the town. So I think that, you know, in some form or fashion, I think I would echo the same words that the member of the board mentioned. I would like to see this granted in an appropriate way with safeguards for the other users of the campus and the neighbors.
Okay.
Thank you.
Chair. Yes, sir.
Sir, if I could ask a quick question.
Surely.
What are your thoughts on weddings?
As you said, I believe weddings are a great deal of fun. I do have great concerns, you know, again, when I see the numbers that could potentially be there. I'm not quite clear yet the maximum number of people who could be in that facility, whether, for example, on a given day, only one of the areas would be in use, or could you have an event that spanned both of those spaces? If I had the numbers up in the application, 525 was the maximum number I came to. That'll be one heck of a wedding. So that worries me greatly. I don't think, again, that restricting away from that would prevent the center from, you know, exercising the right to have a positive environment to generate some funds that clearly are very, very valuable to support the mission. So I'm not comfortable with weddings myself in terms of,
I think
there are other locations that I would prefer to go to.
I think a lot of us are hanging up on outside of them. Thank you, sir.
Okay, thank you.
Any other butters, please? Sir.
Henry Siegel, 112 Hayden Row. I think the it's a wonderful facility. Take my grandson there for music classes, and we love it. One of my questions is, why do we need to have two bar facilities on the first floor and the second floor? I mean, this is one event going on. Why do we need two? Just partly as curiosity.
Yeah, go ahead, Cal. You can just stay there.
Actually, we treat it as two different spaces. If you've been there, the performance center is a very separate space,
mm-hmm.
and the second floor of the bar is limited to 100 people, and it would be a very different event type of space. And that is the reason, because there might be a smaller event that would be helping. Okay. So it would be a temporary bar.
And would you run both at the same time, conceivably?
It would be unlikely, but we did for our gala. I also just want to comment on that number 500. That is a standing number. That there would be no event where there would be 500 people at a wedding. the max would be probably 250 to 300.
And as an abutter with family and so on, we also are very concerned about the hours. Having paid for several weddings myself, which were fun, we did have to limit our hours in the where we rented facilities because of neighboring and so on. And so we, you know, are extremely concerned about the hours and the traffic after a certain hour, as well as on Sundays.
Right.
I understand that. Right. Thank you.
Thank you. Any other abutters? Okay. And a lot of folks here. Can I see a show of hands who wants to speak to this? Anybody? Okay. Actually, a quiet crowd. All right. So let's just go. Anybody who wants to get up and speak, please. You know, name and address. Try to hold it 2 minutes. Try to stay on topic. However you feel fit.
Good evening. Kurt Fligoff, 76 West Elm Street in Hopkinton. And full disclosure, I'm on the HCA board. I'm also a member of the public. I just wanted to say that, you know, as a member of the board, you know, I've got one son that just graduated from high school. I've got another son that's a sophomore at the high school. The concerns that were discussed about kids, the safety of the kids, and the concern for the kids is priority number one for me. That is a crucial issue, and I can guarantee you that we take it with the utmost seriousness. With that, I am confident, I know these people, I am confident that it's going to be run well, it's going to be run responsibly, that is not going to have the blurring effect that I think people are concerned about. We're going to keep that line crystal clear. I do think it is good for the community. I think it will be a nice benefit for the people that come in, see a show, have a glass of wine, enjoy themselves, instead of having to drive into Boston or Providence. We have it in our own backyard. It's a wonderful facility, and I would like to thank you for all the support that you've given to the HC over the course of the year. Thank you.
Chair, sorry, if I could follow up. Kurt, so how many people are on the HCA board?
There are, well, we are in the process of expanding it because we're stretched very thin. I think we have 6 currently, and we're going 8 right now, and we're going to 11.
And does Kelly report to the board?
Yes.
Do you serve as counsel on the board?
Between me and Lana McAuliffe, who's also an attorney, we are giving an awful lot of pro bono time to the board. Whether or not we're formally counsel or not, I don't know. Okay. But yeah, we certainly are trying to guide them through whatever needs to be done so that we're sure that we're doing everything properly.
Last question. All members of the board Hopkinton residents?
I believe so. No? Oh, no. Lynn is not from Hopkinton. Anyone else? And Nancy. So 2 are not.
So the majority are?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thanks, Kurt.
Good evening. Bruce McDonald, 1 Holt Street, right downtown. So I have a little perspective on this. I'd like to echo what Kurt said about Chuck and Kelly being, you know, of paramount concern. You know, no one has the interests of this town more in focus than these people, I think. And so I would suggest that we keep that in mind. Equally importantly, there are no destination points in this town for adults to go to in the evening. I think something like this would make the Center for the Arts that sort of place, this kind of place that my wife and I would go of a Friday or a Saturday evening, where otherwise there are very few decent options in town. So I would just like to make that point and ask you to give it due consideration from that perspective. This is a town that needs to thrive. I mean, when I came home this evening, my wife said Vinny's is closing. That's another example of a business which is not surviving in this town. We need to do something more about this. This is tantamount to that type of thing, that type of development and support that we need to encourage in this town. So thank you.
Jeff, did you want to go?
Yes. Thank you.
Jeff Doherty, 3 Angels Way. As a member of the Community Preservation Commission, I supported funding for this project. I was so impressed when I went to the gala opening to see this building, to see a guy that I went to high school with that was the project manager. And I speak in favor of this because I also worked on the design review board to bring the design components and the finishing touches to this building. It's such a beautiful addition and aspect and continuation of the historic component that went into this. When I read some of the letters and the concerns from the townspeople, I was pretty much confused because I didn't understand, as far as I know, the school doesn't give passes for kids to walk out the door and go anywhere in the town. So my confusion there is, why are we concerned that kids are going to be freelancing to the Center for the Arts? Number two is, if any of you have worked in the restaurant or the beverage industry and understand the liability and the capacity of a server, not just the owner of the facility, not just the applicant, but the server who is involved, third-party liability came about, I want to say, about 35, 40 years ago. So that individual server, if he makes a mistake, if somebody goes out that he has served, that person is liable, as well as Kelly would be and would serve to your question, Brian. So my concern there is that this is such a particular law, and anyone who's in the serving industry understands what their liability is, and we are not sending people over, and this person would be liable to look at a license to see if they are able to be served. Number two, I just wanted to paint a scenario. If you were in July or August, and you were outside at a facility or an event or a function at the Center for the Arts, and someone said, gee, how come you can't have a beer or wine here? And they'd say, well, the school's right there. Well, the school is closed, so we have a 10-week period, not including vacations, where the school is closed, there's no function at the school, and yet we made a ruling that you couldn't serve alcoholic beverages. I think that's, you know, a stretch, but we have to look at common sense, and that would be a question that I'm sure would be raised. Thank you.
Thanks. Anybody else from the public would like to say anything? Sir.
Rob Harris, 7 Canterbury Lane. I've moved to the town about 3 years ago, and I've, the Center for the Arts is really, you know, one of the reasons, it wasn't built, but it was on its way, but it's, you know, sort of just generally one of the reasons I came to the town. It has that sort of that feeling about it. You know, it's a small town feeling. I moved from Boston, like a lot of young people are now, moving out to Hopkinton. So I have a daughter who's 4 and a son who's 6, and my daughter goes to the Center for the Arts, and I sit there in the hallway, you know, while she's in her dance classes and I'm bored, and I look at the there's a, if you haven't been there, there's this chronology of how the Center for the Arts was brought about, and it goes back, I don't know, 15, 20 years or so, and I look at it and I'm it sort of impresses me that people had the vision and the fortitude to stick with the Center for the Arts for so long to get it to the point where it is. And I've actually heard from Chuck before talk about the sustainability of the facility and how they sort of thought about everything from my perspective in terms of, you know, lowering maintenance costs, improving, you know, the solar panels in the roof, and just setting a facility that that just sort of is there for the long haul. And it just seems to me that this is a really good way to help ensure, or not necessarily ensure, but at least give it a better chance of long-term sustainability, where I see there's so many other not-for-profit companies that
just, you know, they get built, they get all this steam behind them, this company starts going, everyone's, you know, donating because they want to build the big building, and then everyone sort of fizzles away, and, you know, and the building gets built and everyone forgets about it. So I just think it's one great way to help the facility continue on in the long haul, and I think that, you know, Chuck and Kelly will do an excellent job at, you know, at fostering that along for the, you know, the years to come.
Thank you. Thank you very much.
Can I ask, is it possible to, or is it appropriate to ask how many people in the room are in favor of it?
I tend to shy away from that because it's kind of a referendum, right? And it's just who showed up here tonight, and so I don't know that that's, you know, we're supposed to think about everyone in town, not just the folks who could make it tonight. Yes, sir, if you want to come up to the microphone, please. Do you also want to be able to drink during your daughter's dance classes? That's what I heard.
I actually don't drink.
I do. Okay.
Friends on the board will test it.
Beautiful Lent.
So my name is Joe Gamble, 22 Appaloosa Circle here in town. I'm a recent member of the board of directors for ESL. I'm encouraged and want to point out three things through three aspects of looking at this. One is responsibility. The second is the financial act. And then the third is our aspect. And then the third is the spirit. So from a responsibility standpoint, I have worked with Kelly and Chris and the rest of the folks involved. And I think others have attested to their level of responsibility and willingness to take on the types of duties and the training that's required to make this successful for everybody. So pointing that out is, I think, really important. The second is financial, and Chuck talked about the financial benefits of this, are very, very clear and important for the longevity of the organization. And third, Todd Sestari, I appreciated your perspective on this, or at least the spirit of this, which is this has an opportunity to be good for everyone. There are concerns. Let's just find a way to mitigate those concerns, resolve those concerns, so that we can create a way that is a win for everybody.
Thank you. Let me have anything new. I think we're starting to say, you may have anything that hasn't been said? Please, ma'am, come on up.
Hello, Barbara Kessler. I am a member of the theater group, and I'm also a neighbor. I'm at 81 Hayden Row Street, so I'm not right next door butter, but I am in the neighborhood. And I just want to point out that some really great things have been brought up. It's so great to be part of a political process that is this friendly and productive. So
we're not all the way through it yet.
Yeah, I know. And I'll speed it up.
We haven't closed the hearing yet. You haven't seen anything yet.
Oh, man, that's it. Now the other shoe's going to drop. Okay.
I just want to say that what was that?
I was just going to say it's pretty evident from the letters that no matter what we do, there are going to be some people who don't like it.
Yeah, and same with the arts. Every show, there's somebody that doesn't like
it. Always a critic. So. We all know. That's how we live together. There's always a critic.
Yeah. So I just want to say that I understand the concerns. I have a recently graduated college freshman who went to high school here, and I have an eighth grader now. But I think this is such a great opportunity to show kids that we can enjoy a glass of wine at a cultural event. And it's not a crazy, you know, night out drinking. And I understand the concerns of that. Truly, I do. But this is an opportunity to say, you know what? This is a freedom we enjoy in our society. And we're going to do it in a responsible way and a respectful way. And we're celebrating the arts. We're celebrating community. And there's all kinds of perspectives on this, and I don't mean any disrespect on the concern about that. But I think there's an opportunity to show another opportunity to, you know, to be free and enjoy this right. So thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Moore. You got a question?
I think you don't. I'm just ready. I just have some comments.
Okay. So, Mr. Kamalo, this is something I think might come up tonight, but I haven't dealt with it before. If we close the hearing, that means no more public input, right? But if the board wants input from anybody, we could still get it, right? Like, I'm thinking about legal counsel, for example. We're not limited on what else we get, right?
That's correct. When we close the public hearing, yeah. Public...
That's what I thought. I just wanted to make sure we were still okay to do whatever we want.
We can do what we want.
Yeah. What's wrong?
I'm just thinking through this issue. If the board intends to follow up on an issue, that was raised during a public hearing, I would rather the information come back from town council to the public hearing.
To the open public hearing?
Yes.
Okay, that's fine. Okay. Yeah, I think we could do it either way, but that's what I was worried about. Okay.
So they have an opportunity to respond.
Yeah, I think for the moment we should keep it open. You know, we can do whatever we want, right? So we'll just sort of keep it going, and then we'll close it at the end when we feel like it goes. So, yes, sir.
Except that.
I didn't really mean we can do whatever we want. I just meant sort of, you know, procedurally, you know.
If the board intends to keep the public hearing open, because this is an application for a liquor license, we need to get the applicant's consent to go beyond the 30-day limit within which the board should take action.
Right. Okay. That may or may not become an issue. Okay, last chance for new comments, you know, non-repetitive statements. Sir. Okay, you bought it. All right, let's go. Shock me.
And I moved to Hopkinton about 3 years ago. We have 3 children. 5, 3, and 1, and I recently joined the board of directors for the HCA, so I just wanted to come up and echo what Chuck and Kurt and others talked about, in that, you know, I joined the board because we made a commitment and we decided to come and move our family to Hopkinton, and seeing this jewel, this gem, and wanting to see the long-term sustainability of it, I wanted to do my part to join to help that happen. And as Kurt mentioned, it takes multiple revenue sources, and the overall mission is the arts, and I'm so excited that it will be here for my children as they grow and go through the whole school system, and have this as an opportunity to learn arts, performance arts, hear speakers, and all the other amazing things that this will bring to the community. I just wanted to voice another, add another voice from the board, just to show that we are fully committed to make sure we're focusing on all the key specific points that everybody's focusing on, the safety of the children, as well as managing and trying to make sure that we have a sustainable, amazing facility that's here for the next 50 years.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Okay. Mr. Mosier.
So I think that the two main points I heard that were driving this was revenue and cumbersome administrative costs around insurance and reapplication and the limitation of the 30 events. I mean, to me, we can talk about all the different legal pathways and reasons why, but the obvious is location as abutting the school and the zoning implications for the residential area. I mean, there's kids going to basketball court there. There's people that walk and run by there all the time. It's a busy place, and it's a busy place populated by people under the drinking age. One of the comments I heard that would stop this in its tracks for me is this becomes an evening destination to replace a restaurant or a bar. That's a deal killer for me. I do think there's a pathway to achieve the first two objectives, but that's to have this locked down prior to the license. And I think what we're talking about right now is putting the cart before the horse. I think we need to get the definitions down, figure out what events are appropriate from a zoning standpoint there, and then we can talk about how to mitigate that against the school events. I think then there's a pathway that can provide some revenue and perhaps relieve some administrative costs, but I think the concept that works for me is going to be somewhat more limited than the concept that is presented tonight.
Okay, so what information do you need?
So I think what I would need to see is how we're going to block it out against school events, what the number of events would be, and what the type of events would be that would occur there.
Okay, fine. And
so basically a negotiation process against the license application.
Right. Yeah, and then also a mechanism.
Not against, but I get it. Yeah, I know what you meant.
And then a mechanism of control also and repercussions.
Well, that's with any liquor license holder, right? So right. We have sort of the standard options.
Well, yes and no. I mean, we can't control certain aspects of the operating hours once we granted a license. In this case, that would have to be that would have to be different.
I'll admit that's a little bit of a hang up because again, you got to sort of have this broad the mechanics of this limitation on 4 hours of opening within the broader confines of the license make it a hassle for somebody to monitor. I'm sorry. Did you have something to say?
Would you entertain a motion to continue the public hearing to a future date such that we can deliberate some this evening and also so that we can formulate a plan to have a discussion with the applicant about some of the concerns raised and that we all share?
I think if we're going to deliberate, we need to close the public hearing. So I think the way you'd phrase it would be to ask, you know, can we ask further questions and sort of, right, get more information, right?
We can leave it open. We can just have this conversation without...
Yeah, we can leave it open. I can continue without even a motion if we want.
Okay.
And then we can...
Because I'd like to...
And then we
try and move it along a little bit tonight.
Right. Now, we need their assent to keep it open, right, to go beyond 30
days.
Okay, so let's spend a few minutes. Oh, you have a few more questions?
Let me just throw out an idea, well, since we're going to keep it going. Just so everyone understands, and maybe...
I know. Sorry, I'm facing right. Go ahead. I thought you'd like that. I'm turning right. Go ahead.
Maybe it's not clear to all. This board recently suspended an alcohol license in town. This board has suspended alcohol licenses in the past. We had an incident recently in the community, and the police chief, one of his concerns, where a certified tip employee of an establishment served an intoxicated individual who then got in a car and ran into somebody else. So we're not like just trying to be a pain in everyone's butt here. This stuff goes on all the time, and we have to be careful and be considerate and weigh all the scenarios. So please understand that we're not out here to be a pain. We're out here to make sure it's safe for everybody in the community. And stuff happens, believe me, and we have to be very careful. So please bear with us.
Okay. Mr. Katina.
Yeah, I just want to know if I could ask Chuck a question, because, you know, listening to a lot of the traffic concerns, what are the hours of the events now? You know, because I don't see many more people or less people coming to an event just because they can get a glass of wine or something. And so what are the events now versus when you would have a liquor license?
Sure. Theater, usually?
Well, it starts at 30. But because we did just open, there are several events that we haven't been able to hold because we didn't have the facility. I just said we just opened. So we haven't been able to have concerts and music series.
Chris, art gallery shows, Chris, about hours?
6:30 to 8:30.
Okay. All right. Mr. Chairman, if I may.
Please.
I think we would welcome the opportunity, if you close the hearing, to have discussions with you about how to formulate this license so that it meets all the requirements. And to Mr. Herr's point, we're in full agreement about safety here. We're partners in this. So if we can get together and put our heads together and come up with something that is legally acceptable in the application process and that meets your needs and our needs and, most importantly, the community's needs, we are wide open to that.
Okay. Good. Anyone else on the board have any questions? Okay, so let me go to you have a question?
I don't have a question.
Oh, let me go to my to-do list, right, the things I heard tonight. So I think the manager issue, I don't know that in the past we've ever approved a license with a manager who wasn't actually already qualified, right? So I'm not saying that necessarily has to get done here in advance, but I do think we should... I think the board would probably feel better if you sort of either had a plan for that or, right? Because I know it's going to take a little time because you have to get everything else done, but we should talk about that. So I think maybe we want to go off and have you all kind of think about how that gets done, right? Get signed up or sort of do the process. I think we need to probably talk about some of these modifications to the license. I think, you know, you've heard the sensitivities in the board, right? I mean, you got this overlap with the school events concern. You've got your offers about only having it for HCA-sponsored events. You got the no alcohol for more than 4 or 5 hours. I'm a little worried that's going to be a little challenging for the chief to figure out how to police that. I think you got a lot of anxiety around private things, these weddings, destination meetings, stuff like that. I don't think you're going to get done with that, to be frank. I think we should understand exactly kind of how you want to run it. I heard some questions tonight from some members of the public, so we should just talk about that anymore, whether there's anything else. And there was a question from one of my colleagues here about the food requirement. Do we want to have food? I don't know that I sense that that's an issue, but we should at least talk it through. So that's kind of my list of open items. I think what I also hear is, well, first of all, okay, so I'm sure unanimously we want the HCA to succeed, right? We get it. It's a hugely valued resource. I think it's going to be one of the great community benefits, right, in this town where we have coming online, well, now and in the next few years. So we're very favorably disposed. I don't think I'm hearing anyone on the board saying they're not willing to do this. I think we just want to kind of get the bumper set so we don't have a catastrophe while we feel our way through this. We know you're figuring this out. We're happy to figure this out with you, but we need to protect against the town's obviously risks, right? And so I think this is all stuff we just have to talk about, and some of you just have to go off and kind of check the box. So I think we can do this very, very quickly, right? You're very good luck. You're all good luck. Ours not so much, is that we're meeting every week here for the near future. So we can take this up again in short order. And I'm happy to put this on the agenda as soon as we get to this point, we can have this conversation. So before
you
I
need
can,
a written extension from them.
Well, I need their assent. I just want to make sure everyone else. I didn't miss anything on anyone's part here about things that they want to make sure we talk through.
The only thing I mentioned was possibility of beer and wine.
Beer and wine only, right? So I think about how much you care about that. And again, we're happy to listen, but let's just think about it. Have an answer. I'm not trying to push you in any direction on any of this. I'm just saying we should have an answer.
So that's one, but if I could just clarify please. One point, Mr. Mosher brought it up, and I think it might have just been a misinterpretation. You're not setting up a bar that people can swing by when there's nothing else going on to hang out, right? You're setting up an event, and then you're going to have alcohol as part of that event. If there's no event, there's no bar. Okay.
So through the chair, but let's be clear, without restrictions on this license...
I didn't say anything about without restrictions.
Okay, so this is where I get hung up. Right?
I understand. I'm with you.
We got to have this figured out before the license.
Totally.
Before we have that real talk about whether we want to do this or not. And while I understand the commitment to the HCA and the financial concerns, we have to make sure that this stays in the spirit of what it was originally created and doesn't become dependent on this as a source of revenue stream. And I absolutely agree with what Chief Lee's words about. You know, what's the message we're sending about what's required to have a good time? That being said, understanding the administrative burden, fundraisers, glass of wine with an art show, I think that kind of stuff is applicable. But we got to have that locked down before this moves forward.
So just to understand fully your thoughts, am I right in saying that's essentially you want to make sure that this bar operation is tied to specific events at the HCA?
Correct.
Right, so it's going to run during X, whatever this event is.
Right, and then we have to sort out.
Well,
X.
I'm not sure we're looking for solutions,
no,
but I'm happy to listen.
We have to sort out X relative to zoning, what's appropriate for the residents, and,
right.
And
okay.
So on and so forth.
I get that part, right? So the ancillary impacts are then your follow-on concern. I'll come to you. Is this to his specific thing? Because I want to go to Mr. Gattino, if not.
Yes.
Okay, fine. Go ahead if it's an answer to that.
Mr. Moja has raised several comments regarding zoning.
Yep.
I think, respectfully, I want to suggest that rather than addressing this as a zoning issue, let's address it in terms of its likely impact on the neighborhood.
Right. I think that's what he's saying.
Fair enough. Yeah. Thank you.
Okay. Mr. Catino.
Yeah, I was just wondering if we're allowed to put a condition that where they get the full liquor license, yet have to send out public safety notifications as if it were a one-day license. Therefore, it saves them the insurance and then allows them to go over the 30-day max, and then that gives visibility to the public safety personnel and to us, and then it opens it up for everybody, and that puts.
Can we think about that for the next meeting? Can we think?
Quick comment,
Mr. Kamal. Can we think about that for the next time?
Yeah, specifically requiring notification to public safety.
Can we think about that?
Event.
Yeah. Let's think about whether that's doable.
I was going to comment. So that, I think that's a very reasonable idea, but I'd feel a lot more comfortable with town council weighing in on what's going to stick and what isn't.
Get it, right. Absolutely. Within the limits of the license. I think, I'm sure.
That's why I said, is it possible?
Yeah. But we're going to figure that out.
Yeah.
Okay. Anything else we want to sort of go through? Okay. I think this is all figure outable. I think we just got to spend a little time figuring it out. What can I do for you now?
Does it make sense?
Dialogue prior to you making a decision, or you want to just do that on your own?
What we're going to do is we're going to ask you to allow us to extend this beyond the deadline.
Yes, we're in agreement.
Assuming you agree, I'm going to continue this hearing, and so we'll leave it open, and we'll continue it until a future date, right, which can be quick. And then Norman will get in touch with you, and we'll schedule some time to sort of talk through all this. I mean, some of this is just homework you all just have to go do. Some of this is we just have to sit down and sort of and think about this a little bit, and then we'll try to come back and sort of wrap it all up.
Much appreciated.
So do I need to formally, does he have to write, put this in writing, or can he just say he's okay with
it? Yeah, we need that tonight, John.
You need it tonight?
I think if you give us another 30 days, that would be helpful.
Yeah.
Okay, we'll draft that up.
Again, I'll put, this will go out on the agenda as soon as we get this, okay. Right? So, like I said, the next 2 weeks we're here.
Okay.
Okay. Maria is there. Okay. So, Chair is going to continue this meeting till a future date to be determined. Okay?
Mr. Chairman.
Thank you all for coming in. Thank you all for being such good guests. Come back anytime. We're always here. So.
See you, Kurt.
Okay, because this is a sort of intermeeting, we're not going to have any of the other things you oftentimes have. Yeah. Chair, I'll entertain a motion to adjourn.
So moved. Second.
Motion, second. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
It's unanimous. Good night, everybody. Thank you.